The House Government Reform Committee looked at the shortage of flu vaccine today. You'll hear from the heads of a few government agencies and the president and CEO of Chiron, a company that withdrew 48 million doses of the vaccine over fears of contamination. The hearing's nearly 4 hours.
Good morning. A quorum being present, the Committee on Government Reform will come to order. I want to welcome everybody to today's oversight hearing regarding this year's U.S. influenza vaccine supply. As most are now aware, on October 5, 2004, the Medicines and Healthcare Products Regulatory Agency, the United Kingdom's version of the U.S. Food and Drug Administration, suspended Chiron Corporation's manufacturer's license for a period of 3 months. Chiron planned on delivering 46 to 48 million doses of flu vaccine, almost half of the U.S. supply. This committee's investigation into the issues surrounding the flu vaccine shortage began at a flu pandemic hearing in February of this year. The committee informed U.S. health officials of its concern that Chiron did not have a manufacturing plant located within the U.S. So should a flu pandemic occur, it was theorized that the U.K. could nationalize Chiron's vaccine supply, resulting in the loss of half of our national supply. At an emergency hearing on October 8, 2004, the committee discussed contributing factors to the flu vaccine shortage, how the government and vaccine manufacturers were responding to and managing the crisis, and what steps would be taken to prepare for next year's flu season. As a result of testimony at these two hearings, Ranking Member Henry Waxman and I sent a letter to the FDA requesting documents that would indicate whether FDA knew about the problems at the Chiron facility and whether FDA responded adequately. As part of this committee's investigation, I led a CODEL to London last week to meet with top-ranking officials from the MHRA and Chiron. The committee also conducted an extensive meeting with FDA officials in Washington to discuss FDA documents and the committee's findings from meetings held in London. These meetings were extremely productive, provided the committee with a timeline of events leading up to October 5th, the standard protocols used by MHRA and FDA, and the steps all parties involved are taking to prevent future vaccine shortages. The FDA documents and investigative meetings held by the committee confirm several key facts. First and foremost, FDA was unaware prior to October 5, 2004, that MHRA would suspend Chiron's manufacturing license. On October 25, 2004, Chiron contacted the FDA to alert the agency there may be a delay in its vaccine shipment as contamination was located in some lots of Chiron's flu vaccine. All documents and meetings confirmed that FDA followed routine protocol in responding to Chiron's initial contact with FDA and continued to follow protocol with each step the agency took after October 25th. Chiron also notified FDA that it had conducted an internal failure investigation to discover how the contamination occurred. It's standard protocol for FDA to have a manufacturer's failure investigative report in hand when conducting an inspection. The FDA uses that report in determining cause, and the report serves as a roadmap for the inspection. Chiron informed FDA that it would receive the internal report the week of October 4, 2004. FDA has informed the committee that it believed this was a reasonable time frame. During this time, FDA was in constant communication with officials from Chiron and immediately alerted the Center for Disease Control and Prevention about the delay in Chiron shipment. Unfortunately, the internal report was not provided to FDA until after Chiron's license suspension. The MHRA, however, was provided with Chiron's findings on September 24, 2004. As a result, MHRA concluded its final investigative visit to Chiron on September 30, 2004. The FDA has since reviewed the report and instructed committee staff that had the agency received the draft report sooner, the Chiron facility would have been reinspected whether or not MHRA suspended Chiron's manufacturing license. FDA, MHRA, and Chiron all agree that Chiron's license suspension resulted from systematic problems within Chiron's Liverpool facility based on a lack of manufacturing oversight and execution. In addition, all parties agree that prior inspections conducted by both FDA and MHRA at the Chiron facility did not foreshadow the license suspension. While some issues at the facility continued from 2003 until September of 2004, Chiron's license suspension wasn't based on contamination in flu vaccine lots or other issues that were addressed in previous inspections. It would be inappropriate to imply that problems at the Chiron facility in 2003 recurred in 2004 and contributed to the closure of the facility. Questions have been asked as to why FDA was kept in the dark regarding Chiron's license suspension until October 5th. Pursuant to the UK's Medicines Act, MHRA is prohibited from sharing commercial information without the consent of the manufacturer involved. FDA, MHRA, and Chiron all informed committee staff that it is widely accepted and understood that the two agencies do not discuss their own actions with regard to companies over which they have each have jurisdiction. In addition, it would be standard procedure for Chiron not to discuss its interaction with FDA or MHRA with the other agency. Since October 5th, Chiron has permitted FDA and MHRA to communicate on all issues. This investigation has been conducted in a bipartisan manner. Politics has no place in the public health arena. I hope that the spirit of cooperation isn't threatened today by those who choose to ignore standard FDA protocol accepted by vaccine manufacturers worldwide and place the sole blame on the flu vaccine shortage on a single agency, rather than taking an objective look at all of the facts presented during the committee's investigation. If protocols need to be tweaked, however, then let's talk about tweaking them. After all, should FDA be held accountable for decisions made by Chiron without its knowledge or for actions taken by MHRA that were legally protected by the law of the UK? If the committee spends too much time placing blame and pointing fingers, we'll be unable to look to the future to ensure that the U.S. has an adequate flu vaccine supply. Let's let experience be our teacher. My main goals in this investigation are to understand the lessons learned from the events leading up to and occurring since October 5, 2004, and most importantly, to work vigilantly with U.S. health officials and private industry to ensure that a similar situation does not occur in the future. Based on my findings with the FDA, MHRA, and Chiron, I'm optimistic that Chiron will be able to produce vaccine for next year's flu season. The license suspension didn't prohibit Chiron from procuring its startup materials for next year. As of today, Chiron has contracted and paid for its egg supply for the 2005-2006 flu season. MHR is extremely pleased with the remediation plan that Chiron has submitted, and a follow-up inspection will be conducted in late December to evaluate Chiron's progress. It's important to recognize there is a need to expand the current number of FDA-approved flu vaccine manufacturers and to bring those manufacturers into the U.S. markets. We're going to work on legislation designed to provide incentives to flu vaccine manufacturers in hopes that we can stimulate the vaccine market domestically. Since our October 8, 2004 hearing, both the Venice Pasteur and MedImmune have been able to produce additional doses of flu vaccine. FDA has also identified and negotiated for approximately 5 million doses of flu vaccine from foreign manufacturers. Additionally, the nation has supply of enough antiviral medicines to treat about 40 million people. These antiviral drugs can be used to prevent or treat the flu if symptoms are identified early. Our witnesses today will discuss how U.S. health officials are procuring and adequately distributing the flu vaccine to the high-risk population and preparing for next year's flu season, and what incentives can be provided to manufacturers to ensure a stable annual flu vaccine supply. In addition, I'm pleased that Howard Pean, the president of Chiron Corporation, is present to speak publicly for the first time since October 5, 2004. I know we're anxious to hear his testimony as to Chiron's remediation plan and how Chiron is moving forward in preparation for next year's flu season. We have an excellent roster of witnesses, and I would like to thank all of them for appearing before the committee and look forward to their testimony. I would now like to yield to Mr. Waxman for an opening statement.
Thank you, Chairman Davis, for holding this hearing on the flu vaccine shortage. You and I share the goal of establishing a healthy vaccine supply in the United States, and effective government oversight is an important part of this process. This year's flu vaccine crisis raises three important oversight questions. The first question is how the United States came to depend on just two companies for the flu vaccine. The Institute of Medicine, the Government Accountability Office, the National Vaccine Advisory Committee have all issued reports exposing the weakness of our national vaccine infrastructure, and we can't afford to ignore their recommendations any longer. And they've been making recommendations since the year 2001. The second question, why the vaccine shortage led to such confusion and chaos? In a series of reports over the last 4 years, GAO repeatedly warned that the United States does not have a plan to ensure that the highest risk people are immunized in the event of a shortage. The seniors who have been standing in lines for hours trying to get a flu vaccine know that GAO is right. And the third question is the primary subject of today's hearing. Did FDA do its job to protect the U.S. vaccine supply? Since the vaccine shortage began, senior administration officials, including acting FDA Commissioner Lester Crawford, have been reassuring the public that the FDA made no mistakes, did everything possible to protect the vaccine supply. Today, we will evaluate those claims. On October 13, Chairman Davis and I asked FDA to provide copies of documents relating to its oversight of the Chiron vaccine plant in Liverpool, England. This is the plant that British regulators shut down on October 5, causing the United States to lose approximately half of its supply of the flu vaccine. We have now received and reviewed over 1,000 pages of documents. We've also met with FDA officials. The chairman traveled to England with majority and minority staff to interview British and Chiron officials. The documents show that FDA failed to provide effective oversight. Expert scientists at FDA knew about serious problems at the Liverpool facility in June 2003, but there was not sufficient leadership at the agency to ensure that they were fixed. My staff prepared a background memorandum for this hearing that describes the documents and their significance in detail, and I ask that this memorandum and the redacted versions of documents cited in the memorandum be made part of the hearing.
No objection. Let me just add to that. I think that all records in the binders before the members, majority and minority members, ought to be made part of the record, and if there's no objection, so ordered.
We have no objection. Well, the Chiron plant in Liverpool was not an ordinary FDA-regulated facility. It's a facility with a history of contamination problems that makes half the supply of the U.S. flu vaccine. The plant should have received the highest priority from the Food and Drug Administration. Yet the agency ignored glaring problems at the facility and missed repeated opportunities to correct them. Mr. Chairman, you said you don't want us to point fingers and look at the past. Let's look at the future. You even, I thought, said you don't want partisanship invoked in our hearings. I don't know what's partisan about criticizing what has led to, in my view, the situation we're facing today. If you don't learn from the past, you're not going to correct these problems for the future. I've been in Congress for 30 years. Throughout this period, oversight of FDA has been one of my highest priorities. I drafted many of the major laws that the agency implements, including the Orphan Drug Act, the Hatch-Waxman Act, the Nutrition Labeling and Education Act, the Safe Medical Devices Act, the User Fee Law that accelerated drug approvals, and the Food Quality Protection Act. That's why I've become so concerned about how the agency has performed in recent years. What we are witnessing is the dismantling of FDA's enforcement and oversight capabilities. In area after area, the agency is failing to enforce the public health laws that Congress enacted. Enforcement actions for misleading drug advertisements, they've dropped 70% since 2001. Enforcement actions at vaccine plants and other manufacturers of biologic drugs have dropped over 80%. Key food labeling laws are being ignored. And there is no better example of what's wrong at the FDA than its failures at the Chiron vaccine facility. The story told in the FDA documents began in June 2003, when a team of FDA inspectors visited the Liverpool facility and found 20 serious problems at the plant, including bacterial contamination and poor sanitary practices. The FDA experts who conducted the inspection recommended the agency take official enforcement action against the company, yet this recommendation was rejected. FDA downgraded its response and asked the company to make only voluntary reforms. FDA's justification for failing to cite the facility is that the agency thought conditions were improving. But conditions weren't improving. They were deteriorating. Over the next 16 months, as production at the facility increased, the problems found in June 2003 mushroomed. Yet during this entire period, the FDA never once revisited the plant to see if Chiron was correcting its problems and making safe vaccines. Incredibly, FDA remained passive even after October 25, 2004, when Chiron disclosed that millions of doses of vaccine were contaminated by a potentially lethal form of bacteria. A responsible regulator would have inspected the plant, demanded to review its production records, and convened high-level meetings of the agency's top experts. That's exactly what the British regulators did. A senior British health official summed up their philosophy as, "Seeing is believing." By contrast, FDA conducted oversight by conference call, trusting a stream of false assurances by Chiron that the plant had no serious problems. FDA conducted no inspection. It reviewed no plant records, and it was caught completely by surprise when British regulators shut down the plant on October 5. FDA's laxity has had a heavy cost. If FDA had ensured that the problems identified in June 2003 were fixed, this year's flu crisis might never have happened. And if FDA had responded aggressively to the contamination problems in August, our public health system would have had critical extra weeks to prepare for the shortage and to avoid the chaos that ensued in October. It is essential for FDA to learn from its mistakes, but so far the administration has been unwilling even to admit them. In recent weeks, the president, the HHS secretary, the acting FDA commissioner have all reassured the public that FDA did everything right. The acting commissioner has even indicated he would do it all over again the same way. After the flu crisis broke, Dr. Crawford, and I might point out that all those assurances given all before the election might be viewed as partisan because there at least we are facing election. We don't have an election now. The election is over. So if we are critical of something that's going on through oversight, that shouldn't be attacked as partisan. After the flu crisis broke, Dr. Crawford told the public that the June 2003 inspection had, quote, no relevancy to the problems found in 2004. He said that FDA monitored the actions of Chiron and ensured that the violations found in 2003 were corrected. And he said that the U.S. and British regulators had acted in synchrony. Well, none of these statements are true. In this administration, inconvenient facts are simply ignored. This is a dangerous way to govern, and it's particularly hazardous for the public health. I respect the chairman may disagree with me today about the interpretation of some of the FDA documents. That's his right. But even as we disagree over specifics, I want to commend the chairman for his approach to this hearing. He has asked for the right documents. He has worked with us to ensure that we can release redacted copies so that members and the public can judge their significance for themselves. That's exactly the right way to approach this important hearing, and I hope after we've had a chance to hear the testimony and ask the tough questions that we will feel better informed about what happened to make sure that it doesn't happen again. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. I know a lot of members would like to make opening statements, but if we go through this, we'll never get to our panel, and our conference is still going on. So what I'd ask is members, we'll give them a week to submit written statements for the record, and of course on the questions they could make statements and use their time to do that. We're going to move to our first panel of witnesses, Dr. Julie Gerberding, the Director of the CDC, Dr. Anthony Fauci, the Director of the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases, and Dr. Lester Crawford, the Acting Commissioner of the Food and Drug Administration. They're going to discuss efforts being taken at the federal level to manage the flu vaccine crisis. They'll also describe their efforts to coordinate distribution with state and local authorities and what steps are being taken in preparation for next year's flu season. As our policy, we swear all witnesses in. You've all been here before, so if you'd please rise and raise your right hand. You solemnly swear the testimony you're about to give to be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. I do. Thank you very much. Dr. Gerberding, we'll start with you. And as you know, we have a light here. Your entire statement is in the record. And I can tell you that our staff and Mr. Waxman's staff have been through the written testimony. We'd like you to, if you could, try to limit your testimony to 5 minutes. You have a light in front of you. When the light turns orange, 4 minutes are up. When it's red, 5 minutes are up. And when it's red, if you could move to completion as quickly as possible. I don't want to cut you off if you think there's something you need to say, because this is televised and people are watching. But we're conscious that we have a lot of questions and give you ample time to amplify at that point. Dr. Gerberding, thank you for being with us. Please go ahead.
Thank you, and I thank you and the staff of the committee for their incredible interaction and professionalism in helping us prepare and be responsive to this hearing. CDC is in a situation where we're faced with two big goals. One is to do our part to assure that we do have a modern vaccine available to everyone who needs it, that's safe, effective, affordable, and accessible, and it's produced in a domestic manufacturing process that's reliable and robust. But we have a second urgent goal, and that is to assure that the vaccine we do have this year gets to the people who need it the most as quickly as possible. And I would just like to start by thanking some very important health protection heroes who have been doing their part. First and foremost, I thank the people who have been patiently waiting in lines and persistently trying to find vaccine. I'm sorry that they're in this situation. We are doing everything we can to get the vaccine that is available out. I also thank the people who've stepped aside to let those who need the vaccine get it. I am incredibly appreciative of Aventis, who's collaborated with CDC's allocation plan, and both Aventis and Chiron and the distributors who have made proprietary information available to health officials so that we can do a good job of targeting the vaccine. Most importantly, I thank the true heroes of this whole process, which are the state and local health officials who have been working around the clock to assess the needs, assess the flu situation in their jurisdictions, and make hard decisions about where to allocate vaccine at the local level. On the next graphic, I have a picture of the current flu situation as of the end of a week ago. The current situation is good news. The season is not off to a fast start. We have local flu activity or sporadic flu activity in many states. We still have some states with no flu activity. But as we pointed out on the next graphic, flu is very unpredictable. The peak month of flu activity is very unpredictable. February is the most common peak, but it can be earlier or later than that. We also know that demand for flu vaccine is unpredictable. We've seen this year a great increase in demand, and certainly we've learned that the supply is unpredictable. So this situation is getting us off to a time where we have a little more time to get vaccine out, but we are not resting until we have every dose allocated. On the next graphic, I've just put an organizational chart of the CDC operation. We have activated our Emergency Operations Center to handle the logistics of the flu season this year. It involves several hundred people across CDC and public health agencies who are working on various tasks. First and foremost among them is allocating vaccine. CDC is using about 20 times more dollars for flu this year than we did in 2000, and so we are doing everything we can to utilize those dollars and achieve the best possible flu preparedness that we can. In August, when we learned of the shortage, we purchased vaccine for the stockpile in addition to those doses that we had purchased earlier in the year. We also increased our supply of antiviral medication for the stockpile. And more recently, after the loss of the vaccine was noted in October, we've increased by 5 million treatment courses, antivirals, for the stockpile. We've also, in August, initiated a survey to assess states' preparedness and contingency planning for reprioritization and reallocation of vaccine, and took a number of steps within the agency to have some contingency for worst-case scenario, although we were operating on the premise that the most likely scenario is that ultimately we would end up with an unprecedented supply of vaccine. On the next graphic, I just have given a very few snapshots of the kind of traditional flu tracking we do at CDC. This involves people across our health agencies. We do laboratory typing, state-based typing, mortality tracing of both adults and pediatric populations. But on the next graphic, I've demonstrated some of the new innovations that we're utilizing this year that never have been used before to track flu. Chief among them is an ongoing household survey where we can assess people people's vaccine status on an ongoing basis. In the first week of November, through the household survey, we were able to determine that our targeting efforts are working. Only 4% of low-priority patients have been vaccinated this year, and for those that need it most, including the seniors over age 65, we have more than 26% vaccine coverage, which is about where we would be at the midpoint of the flu season. The last graphic really illustrates the most important component of all, and that is that flu is a preventable illness. Vaccine is the most important component of prevention, but there are other steps that we have to focus on this year as well, including prevention of person-to-person transmission, respiratory hygiene, hand hygiene, and of course antivirals. For people who cannot get the flu vaccine but need it, it's very important that they seek medical attention at the earliest onset of flu, because antiviral drugs can treat flu and prevent the serious complications. So we want to make sure that word gets out widely. And of course, we are also preparing for a worse flu season than usual through other interventions at the community and institutional level if we need them as we go down the road. So there are a number of things ongoing across the agency, and we really appreciate the support of Congress in helping us get there. We know we need to do more. We know that we have requested $100 million in the 05 budget to modernize our vaccine strategy, and we look forward to working with you and the committee and others on how we can do this expeditiously and successfully. Thank you.
Thank you. Before we get to Dr. Fauci, Mr. Waxman.
Yeah, Dr. Fauci, before we hear from you, I want to express my feelings, and I think the feelings of the members of this committee, about the loss of, and it was a sudden loss of a leader in infectious diseases, your deputy, Dr. John LaMontagne. Members may not have known him personally, but he was a person from whom we all benefited. He worked on issues such as flu vaccination, biodefense research, malaria, and tuberculosis. He was held in the highest esteem by all of his colleagues. He had an exemplary public service record. I know it's a loss to you and I think to the country that he has suddenly passed away.
I concur with that. He's.
Thank you very much, Mr. Waxman, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. We really appreciate the recognition that you've given to John LaMontagne. It is a fact that John was one of the leaders in an influenza vaccine research. And in fact, when he first came to the National Institutes of Health almost 30 years ago, he was the first influenza program officer in our research enterprise. So I think he would be particularly interested in this hearing were he here today. And thank you for your recognition. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to take my time allotted to me now to talk to you a bit about the research approach towards tackling and meeting the challenge of influenza, both the immediate challenge and the long-range challenge, including that of pandemic flu. As shown on this first poster, the NIH influenza research is one of the components of the Department of Health and Human Services' comprehensive program involving surveillance, regulation, and research to not only understand the influenza virus and the disease's cause, but also to help us partner better with industry in order to overcome some of the challenges that we've been meeting over these past several months. Research endeavor is comprised of both basic research, research capacity, a bit of surveillance, which as you know is fundamentally what the CDC does, but the end point is to develop vaccines, therapeutics, and diagnostics. This particular slide showing the influenza funding I think is very telling because it shows the effort that has been put in under the leadership of Secretary Thompson at the department in expanding our capabilities. As you can see, in 2001, our research endeavor was about $20 million, and the President's budget for 05 is approximately $66 million, a clear, rather impressive increase in resources. Some of the scientific issues that were tackled are of importance to the discussions that are taking place here today. Many of you have heard of the terminology reverse genetics. I'll try to simplify that for you. This was a technique that was developed by NIH grantees. And what this technique does, it takes some of the uncertainty out of finding and isolating the seed virus to grow for a vaccine. And when you get a virus like isolated this year, the H5N1 from Asia, and you want to grow that to develop a pilot lot, you generally put a vaccine that is well adapted to growing in eggs, which is the main medium of growing, together with the vaccine in question, hoping that they will naturally reshuffle their genes so that you'll have the component of the virus in question within the framework of a virus that you know from year after year grows well. Reverse genetics circumvents that. It allows you to actually pick out the genes and deliberately put them together to form a hybrid type of a virus that we call a reassortant, that will then, a molecular version of the reassortment, where you deliberately do it yourself. That's how we isolated and got the H5N1 that we're now preparing for a vaccine in the event of a pandemic flu. The next slide shows the two major research endeavors that are ongoing now to tackle the question of how we can have alternatives to egg-based vaccine. And that is the development of cell culture vaccine production and recombinant DNA technology. Hopefully we'll get a chance to discuss this during the question period. Another important component of tackling influenza is what we do with therapies. Therapies that are for the actual treatment of influenza, as well as those that can be used for prophylaxis or prevention. There are four drugs that are available today against different targets. Three of them are used for prevention, and all of them can be used for treatment. We need a more robust pipeline to be able to have in our armamentarium other drugs in the event of the development of resistance to these drugs by the influenza virus. And we know from experience that whenever you treat a microbe over a period of time, sooner or later there will be resistance. But we do have drugs, as was mentioned by Dr. Gerberding, such as Tamiflu and Remantadine in our strategic national stockpile, with, in fact, many more doses now being prepared for that stockpile. And finally, let me just mention a word of how we use the research enterprise to approach the pandemic flu threat that is an ever-looming threat. We know that this is occurring in Asia right now. H5N1 is a virus that has already infected 44 people and killed 32. The good news is that it has not yet learned how to effectively transmit from person to person. There's only one documented case. But if we use history to tell us what microbes can do, sooner or later, either this virus or a related virus might learn that. So there are some research issues that need to be addressed that will help us to be able to meet that challenge. They're listed here. One is to isolate that virus, which we, in collaboration with the CDC and the WHO last year, did. And we did it by the reverse genetics technique that I introduced you to just a moment or two ago. We're developing pilot lots of the H5N1 and other bird flus. By pilot lots, we mean small amounts, 8 to 10,000, that can be used in clinical trials, as shown on the third bullet. Those clinical trials will begin anywhere from January up to and including March or April. And this has been in association with the purchase by the department of 2 million doses of H5N1 from Aventis Pasteur to be able to have in our stockpile should we need it. And finally, the continual screening and development of new therapeutics. So in summary, as part of the broad comprehensive approach of the department, the NIH research endeavor will hopefully continue to contribute productively to the challenge that we will inevitably meet. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. Dr. Crawford, thank you for being with us. You need to push your button there.
On August 25, 2004, Chiron informed FDA that the company had discovered bacterial contamination in 8 lots of final vaccine product for this year's flu supply, and advised that they were already investigating the problem to determine the root cause of the contamination. At the same time, they proceeded to quarantine all of the vaccine lots while they retested the product. In September 2004, FDA, CDC, and Chiron scheduled weekly conference calls to discuss the status of the firm's investigation. During these calls, they advised FDA that they had identified the cause of the contamination and that it was confined to specific vaccine lots. During their investigation, Chiron informed FDA that the results of the retesting were negative. They plan to submit a final investigative report to FDA during the week of October 4th. It's important to recall that on September 28, Chiron's chief executive officer advised the Senate Special Committee on Aging, quote, as of September 27th, it remains Chiron's expectation that between 46 million and 48 million fluvirin doses will be delivered to the U.S. market beginning in early October. On the morning of October 5, 2004, the British regulatory organization, MHRA, announced a three-month suspension of Chiron's license to manufacture influenza vaccine. FDA had no prior knowledge of that intention to suspend the firm's license. The chief executive of MHRA indicated that they did not have the legal authority to notify FDA before the October 5th suspension. Upon learning of the suspension, FDA contacted both Chiron and the MHRA. Chiron indicated to FDA that it believed it had satisfactorily addressed MHRA's inspectional findings. However, the British expressed serious concerns about Chiron's vaccine stocks and the company's ability to assure the safety of the vaccine. FDA immediately dispatched a senior team of scientists to the UK to meet with company officials and MHRA and to inspect Chiron's Liverpool manufacturing facility. On October 15, 2004, after completing its inspection, FDA determined that it could not adequately assure that Chiron's vaccine met our safety standards. As a result, Chiron will not supply any influenza vaccine to the U.S. market for the 2004-2005 flu season. In coordination with others at the Department of Health and Human Services, we have been actively exploring all viable options to secure additional dosage of flu vaccine to provide more Americans protection against the flu. Through these efforts, we have been able to increase the available supply of licensed flu vaccines for the U.S. population to 61 million doses for this flu season. We have also been contacting manufacturers worldwide in an effort to identify increased supplies of antiviral medications that will provide further protection and treatment for Americans during this flu season. Next year, Aventis Pasteur believes they have the capability of producing the same or more doses of influenza vaccine. In addition, MedImmune has indicated that it has the capability to produce 10 million doses of flu mist for the 2005-2006 season, and as much as 40 million doses by 2007. In partnership with the MHRA, we will continue to work with Chiron in an effort to bring them back online for next year's flu vaccine production. We're also encouraging foreign licensed manufacturers to apply for U.S. licensure, and we will work to help them achieve this goal. Looking further ahead, we must develop more efficient ways to produce flu vaccine so that we have the flexibility to deal with shortages or unexpected problems. The Department has requested $100 million for fiscal year 2005 to shift vaccine development to new cell culture technologies, as well as to provide for year-round availability of eggs, for egg-based vaccine. We urge Congress to fully fund the $100 million requested, and we are encouraged by the positive response from Congress on this important request. To help manufacturers overcome challenges such as the vaccine development problems that Chiron is experiencing, FDA has been investing its energy and resources in important initiatives such as the Current Good Manufacturing Practices for the 21st Century Initiative, or the GMP Initiative. Under that initiative, FDA is working with industry to encourage the use of advanced technologies as well as quality systems and risk-based approaches that build quality into the manufacturing process and avoid the problems such as those Chiron experienced. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Mr. Waxman, I have agreed that to begin the questioning, we'll take 15 minutes, and then Mr. Waxman will get 15 minutes on his side, and then we'll go down and allow individuals to get their 5 minutes should they desire to do so. Dr. Crawford, let me start the questioning. FDA provided the committee with the Form 483s from the June 2003 and the October 2004 inspections of Chiron's Liverpool facility. And there's an important point, because a lot has been made about a duty, perhaps, of the FDA to have gone back and continued to inspect that plant prior to October of 2004. Could you explain the differences between these two forms and why, even though some similarities exist between faults that were found in the June 2003 inspection and October 2004 inspection, that Chiron's license suspension in October of 2004 was not foreshadowed by the June 2003 inspection?
Well, the two events were unrelated. In 2003, we inspected the plant and were involved with it, and we did issue Form 483, which cites some corrections that must and should be made, and the plant responded affirmatively. We were able to interact with them in a productive way, and the proof of that was is that the 2003 vaccine production was completed on schedule, and none of it was condemned, as was the case in 2004. So they are two entirely separate situations. The 2004 situation was quite different.
When the team biologics returned to the U.S. after its June 2003 inspection of Chiron's Liverpool facility, it initially recommended that official action be taken against the facility. FDA ultimately decided that voluntary action should be taken. Could you explain to us the protocol FDA follows in deciding actions after routine inspections of manufacturing facilities?
Yes. The inspectors that actually do the evaluation on site come back and make a recommendation as to what kind of action FDA should take, if any. And then Team Biologics actually has a decision-making process so that all of the members of the team are able to evaluate the severity of the situation and also what progress is being made. By that time, they did have the response from the company to the 483, and based on that and also based on the fact that that vaccine production process last year did come to full and successful completion, the report was, the action was changed from mandatory to voluntary.
FDA's routine protocol, as I understand it, is to inspect foreign manufacturers once every 2 years?
That's correct.
The last routine inspection of Chiron's Liverpool facility then was June 2003. FDA informed the committee it accepted Chiron's response plan to correct the issues that were raised in June 2003, and therefore the file was closed on September 3, 2003. Is that correct?
That's correct.
If these steps were following standard FDA protocol, would there be a reason for FDA to go back to Chiron's Liverpool facilities prior to the 2 years time to reinspect?
No, we don't do that.
So you were following protocols?
Yes.
Let me just ask you this. In retrospect, in retrospect, now that we've seen what happened, is there anything an inspection in that time period might have shown that had we gone back? I know it wasn't within protocol.
No, within the number of years that we've been doing this for decades, this has been our standard protocol. It's modified somewhat from time to time in order to deal with the good manufacturing practices as practices within the industry change. But the sequence of events has been unchanged over recent years and has been very effective. This is the first time we've had contamination in final lots of vaccine at that plant. And that was a different kind of thing, and but we would not have changed the protocol leading up to that.
You believe that the causes of the contamination in the vaccine in October of 2004 were unrelated to the initial reports that we got back in June of 2003 and potential contaminations at that point?
Yes. The flu vaccine composition has changed each year based on the expected strain, so this was an entirely different production.
Now, let me step ahead a little bit and try to understand that. Everyone's goal this year, MHRA, Chiron's, the FDA, is to get Chiron up and running so they can produce flu vaccine next year. They've gone ahead and ordered the eggs. They have invested financially in being able to go ahead next year and get the doses up and the supply ready for the U.S. But if Chiron isn't up and operating, if something goes wrong, if the changes that they are making within their plant operations somehow do not pass muster and we still have contamination, can you tell the committee what's our plan B?
Well, we will, at that point, it'll be early enough for us to seek alternative production facilities, but also alternative sources of vaccine from other countries and elsewhere. So that will be a signal to both the British and to us that we need to work with their version of the Centers for Disease Control and our version of our own CDC in order to work together to secure an adequate vaccine supply from other sources if, in fact, they're not going to be able to provide it. As you recall, we testified in 2002 that the vaccine industry was extremely fragile. We'd be down to a very few suppliers, and we needed to work on that. When you find out too late in the production season, it's too late to seek alternative sources because they can't get up and running fast enough. We'll be earlier than that this year.
You also, you have foreign licensed manufacturers. In fact, Chiron has other plants, do they not, where they manufacture vaccine?
Mm-hmm.
Are we in the process of going out to other manufacturers that are currently providing a dosage for Europe and for other parts of the free world and have met criteria in other countries to get those licenses as well so that should this occur again, we have other sources of supply?
Yes, I have personally talked to every chief executive officer manufacturing flu vaccine anywhere in the world, even those that have elected not to come to the U.S. market, and have encouraged them to do that, and also have encouraged them of the commitment of FDA to work with them in that process, because we need more competition, if you will, within the flu vaccine industry. I've also talked to the manufacturers of substances like flu mist, and also the antiviral drugs, and have assured them also of their of our commitment. Some of them, the antiviral drug manufacturers, also have chosen to not enter the U.S. market. I've encouraged them to rethink that, and we're having a continuing series of calls on a virtually daily basis in order to see what their thinking is and also to work with them.
It is true that worldwide there is a shortage of flu doses. It's just that in the more affluent parts of the world, we tend to be able to go out and buy it and usually have ready supply. Is it?
Yes. Dr. Gerbening would be better able to talk about that, but we consume more than our share of the flu vaccine that's produced worldwide. That is as it should be. We have a very aggressive public health program, thanks to CDC, and we're moving forward, I think, to vaccinate an even larger percentage of our population. But the number of people that are, number of companies that are actually manufacturing are down really to about 3 or 4.
Dr. Gerbening, is that accurate statement?
That is accurate. I don't have the global production figures this year. We can get them for the committee, but in most years it's less than a total of 300 million doses globally.
Okay. What is the annual death toll from influenza around the world? We know it's averages around 36,000 in the United States on an annual basis. What would it be worldwide? Any idea?
We don't have accurate estimates globally because there really is no system for surveillance for flu on an international basis. We're working on that, but I can't answer the question.
Let me go back to you, Dr. Crawford. What are Chiron's obligations to FDA in order to get their license back to produce flu virus vaccines for next year's flu season? And how are you working with Chiron and the MHRA to develop and implement the remediation plan? And how confident are you that we're going to be successful?
Thanks to an agreement that has been reached between the MHRA, FDA, and Chiron, we're now able to share information and also to work together in working and helping to get the vaccine production facility.
And that's the first time we've had that, correct?
It is, yes.
In fact, without that, under British law, they couldn't share this with
they
you.
They could not and did not share information. We're now working hand in glove to get that particular plant up and functioning. And a decision will be made on that by January 5. Now, it's important to note that since the facility is in the United Kingdom, the license will come from the British government.
Correct. And we've talked about the plan B, that if at that point you still have time to look worldwide into other areas.
Yes.
Let me ask you another thing. We have some jurisdictions, State of Illinois, City of New York, that are talking about importing vaccines from countries that are not FDA certified.
Yes.
What are we doing about that?
Some governors and mayors have come to FDA and have offered to go and try to find vaccine that's still unused in wholesale distribution channels. And they have found, starting with the governor of Illinois and then the last one to enter the situation was the mayor of New York City. They've come up with up to 750,000 extra doses. And what we're doing now is we had to first collect the lot numbers on those doses in order to be sure that they were legitimate, that they came from the plant where they're supposed to have come from. The second thing is now we are developing what's called a pedigree, and that is to be sure that we know where all this vaccine has traveled throughout the world and whether or not the cold chain, as it's called, that is refrigeration, has been in place sufficiently and adequately to make sure that the vaccine is still viable and can be used. We're down to that point now, and then we're also meeting with that CEO on a regular basis as they help us to get the data we need in order to bring the vaccine in. Now, it is not approved in the United States, so we'll have to do some special procedures in order to bring it in, but we're not at that point yet, but we're making progress.
Okay, I would just emphasize from my perspective, you know, for next year and the years after, we just need to get more providers out there. And if we can't get them to produce it here, we've got to go worldwide to just get them certified where they can do that. And also the flu mist, are we looking at testing that to see if that could have a wider applicability than it has?
Well, as I mentioned, they are going up to 10 million doses. And as you also know, it's now used for people that are in healthy physical condition between the ages of 5 and 49. The company has released information that they're interested in perhaps expanding that, perhaps to some further ages. And I can assure you, although we can't reveal the procedures and what's going on in terms of the data that's been submitted to us and the relevant applications, we'll do everything we can to work with them or anyone else who wants to expand a flu vaccine product in the U.S. market.
Yeah, okay. Dr. Gerberding, let me ask you, getting parochial, Virginia, Maryland, and D.C., this whole region, we're all heavily dependent on Chiron to supply our vaccines for the public sector. How has the CDC worked with Aventis to redistribute the portion of the Aventis flu zone doses to states that contracted solely with Chiron?
On October 5th, 33 million doses of Aventis vaccine had already been distributed, but there were a projected 25 million doses left to be allocated. The first phase of allocation was targeted to people who need the vaccine the most. So looking at the Aventis purchasers as well as the public sector purchases, we did everything we could to assure that we got all the doses out, the Vaccine for Children program, to doses going to nursing homes and to other high priority, obvious areas where there were most likely to be people who needed it. Once that plan was developed and implemented, then the remaining 12 million or so doses needed to be allocated. And in this step, the state health officials stepped in and said, we will work with CDC and Aventis to target those doses of vaccine to the places in our communities that need vaccine the most. And so the states have really done an assessment of where it's needed, how it's needed, and we've made sure it's gotten there. In this process of working with the states to allocate the vaccine, we have made available to them for the first time ever proprietary information on a secure web base that tells them not just how many doses, but exactly who Aventis was planning to ship it to. And also the Chiron distributors have been providing that information now as well. So the doses are going at the direction of the state health officials to the people in those jurisdictions who need them the most.
Let me ask, if you go back to October, it looked like we have about 50 million doses nationally. Is that about right, available?
In October, we had already used 33 million of the...
But I'm talking about total doses available. With Chiron not being able to produce it, we were going to be around 50 million doses. Is that right?
A total of 61 million doses total this year, including 3 million doses of the flu mist.
But part of that is because we have stepped up efforts since October, isn't
right,
that correct?
Exactly.
I'm just saying it was
Aventis
about
had a higher than expected
right.
yield, and they were also able to get a few million more doses out of the production line.
So we're up to 61. Will that go any higher, do you think, looking at some of the foreign distribution? We're looking at Dr. Crawford. Do you know we were at 75
yes.
million doses last year. What do we expect to be at the end of the flu season? How many doses can we reasonably expect to have on the street available to the public? Anybody want to take a stab at that?
We have made contacts with a variety of companies, and we're in final negotiations with three of them that are in other countries. And it's possible we'll have an additional 5 or 6 million doses cleared for a shipment to the United States by the first of the year. The exact figure we don't know at this point because we're continuing to negotiate, but we have sent inspectors to those plants, and they have filed their findings, and I expect to have on the first plant, which is actually the largest one, a recommendation by the end of this week, and then I can make a determination as to whether or not it meets U.S. standards and can be brought in under special circumstances.
You would agree, though, we need more suppliers just to avert this kind of thing in the future. Would everybody agree with that?
Absolutely.
Yes.
And that means the FDA is going to have to be proactive in going out and getting some of these other areas licensed. Is that a fair assumption?
Yes.
And Dr. Gerber, let me just conclude. What lessons from our response to this year's flu vaccine shortage are really relevant to bioterrorism preparedness?
Well, the systems that we've been using to track and allocate flu this year are the same systems that we would use for a pandemic or for a terrorism event. I think it's been a challenging exercise. We have been asking a lot of our public health system in this regard, but the laboratory network, the communication network, the emergency operations network, and really the countermeasure allocation system that we've executed are all critical components of any emerging threat, including terrorism.
And they're working pretty well under these circumstances.
Well, so far we have been very pleased with the steps that have been taken and the success that we've had. But again, it's early in the season and we have a long way to go before we're through with this.
Thank you very much. Mr. Waxman, you have 15 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Crawford, I want to start my questions with you. In 1999, the Food and Drug Administration inspectors went to this Liverpool plant, and they identified manufacturing problems. This was before Chiron purchased it. And the inspectors responded to these problems by issuing a warning letter. And as I understand the significance of a warning letter, it's an official enforcement action. If the manufacturer doesn't correct the problems, or remedy the violations, FDA can initiate legal action against them. So it's a serious matter. And in addition, once there's a warning letter, it generally ensures that another inspection will be conducted to make sure the problems have in fact been fixed. So that's what happened in 1999. In June 2003, FDA inspectors went out again. There were four inspectors, as I understand it, to look at this Chiron plant in Liverpool, and they found bacterial contamination, in some cases 1,000 times higher than expected. They found unsanitary practices. They found the plant was not doing an adequate job investigating and correcting these problems. The June 2003 inspection team recommended, as I understand it unanimously, that there be an official action, as there was in 1999. And instead of a warning letter being sent, which would be official actions, the recommendation was, quote, downgraded to a request for voluntary action by the company, a request that carries no legal weight and that did not lead to a prompt follow-up inspection. What I'm concerned about is, why did FDA downgrade its response and ask for only a voluntary action?
It's because of the progress that the plant was making. We issued what's called a 483, which is a statement of what we think should be corrected. We stayed in touch with the plant as they moved towards the end of that production cycle. Two things happened. They responded very well. They corrected the problems. And then the vaccine production for that in that plant for that year, which was ready for our evaluation a few weeks later, turned out to be okay. The 2003 production was not contaminated, and so they had, in fact, completed wanted them to do, and there was no need to have a mandatory or a warning letter.
Well, there was no need, but there could have been, and that would have enforced another inspection. In fact, did FDA go back to the plant to inspect whether conditions in the plant were actually improving as you thought they were or you hoped they were? And did you schedule another inspection, as FDA would likely have done if you had taken an official enforcement action?
Well, two things happened, as I mentioned.
Could you answer yes or no on that question?
Pardon me?
Could you answer yes or no?
Would you restate the question?
Well, you didn't send an official letter, which would require a follow-up inspection, and what you thought things were improving. And I want to know, did FDA go back to the plant and inspect whether the conditions in the plant were actually improving, as you hoped they were, and did you schedule another inspection, as FDA would have done had you issued an official letter?
Not possible to answer that yes or no, because we did go back in August of 2004. If that's the question, the answer is yes.
Well, the answer wouldn't be yes, because under an official letter, you would have gone back earlier than that.
But they corrected the problems.
Well, how do you know they corrected the problems?
Because we got the vaccine produced, and it was okay.
That was the final product.
In 2003.
But in the 2003 inspection, your people said that there were unsanitary conditions there, that there's a high bacterial contamination. Maybe it wasn't in the final product that you saw, but it certainly became the reason why the British shut down the plant in 2004. Isn't that correct?
No, that's not correct.
It's not correct. Okay, we'll get to that in a minute. I think it was a mistake for you not to have gone back earlier than 2004. If you'd issued an official letter, you would have had to gone back earlier. And the reason it was a mistake is conditions weren't getting better as you thought they were. They were deteriorating. But because you weren't there in the plant until 2004, when we already had a problem that was much worse, you had no idea how bad things actually were. Unfortunately, what happened at the Chiron plant, I think, is emblematic of larger problems at your agency. But let me get to that in a minute as well. FDA inspected the flu vaccine supply in June 2003. The report of the inspectors found serious problems in 20 areas of vaccine manufacturing and distributing. You stated that FDA's oversight in 2003 had no relevancy for 2004. I want to ask you first about the finding of high bioburden, meaning high levels of bacteria in the vaccine production process. In 2003, FDA found evidence of bioburden more than 1,000 times higher than expected, even after they had this filtration system to stop it. FDA also found that on repeated occasions, the vaccine pools had been contaminated with potentially lethal bacteria called serratia, and FDA even found contamination in the vaccine after sterile filtration, which is supposed to eliminate any potential for bacterial growth. Now, isn't it not true that if these findings of high bioburden, how you could say that they had no relevancy to the problems that led to the closure of the plant in 2004?
As you mentioned earlier, in 1999, we had the same sort of problem with the bioburden. As you know, every vaccine production lot starts off with a bioburden, and production is in large place decontaminating it, and so that it goes back to a sterile situation. After 1999, we had a perfectly fine production in 2000. After the findings of 2003, that vaccine turned out to be okay. There was no linkage between it and what happened in 2004.
Well, in the documents that we finally got from you, and it took a while to get it, this was the inspection in 2004. They talked about this high bioburden in the lots, and they said not corrected from previous inspections of 2003, in that similar occurrences noted during this inspection. So when they went back in 2004, the FDA inspectors found the same problems they found in 2003, a high level of bacteria that can contaminate the supply. And I think this is a key point. In 2003, FDA found problems at the company investigating sterility failure. And it was the failure at the plant to investigate and correct the 2004 contamination that led to the shutdown.
No, that's not correct. Bioburden is present in every production lot of flu vaccine. It starts with a bioburden, and then the point is that the bioburden has to be reduced and eliminated.
They had problems with the bioburden. It was 1,000 times more than it was supposed to have been. Is that right?
What year are you talking about?
Well, in 2003.
They had problems, but they were able to decontaminate it, so the vaccine actually went on the market.
But your inspectors went back in 2004, and they said the problem had not been corrected for the bioburden. When you finally went back in October 15, 2004, you found a high bioburden that hadn't been adequately investigated. You also found and this inspection expressly stated it wasn't corrected from the previous inspection in 2003. When you read these documents, it's clear that the bioburden problems and Chiron's failure to be able to identify and correct them were a significant factor behind the closure of the facility. They existed in 2003. They weren't corrected. They got worse in 2004. As I mentioned, the FDA inspectors in 2003 found evidence of contamination in the vaccine even after sterile filtration that is supposed to remove all bacteria. A potential source of contamination was identified in the aseptic connections between the tanks of the vaccine and the formulation area. So in June 2003, FDA found that the company had failed to address these problems with these connectors. And this year, Chiron investigated its most recent contamination problems, and the company found a major weakness and possible cause of the contamination in the aseptic connections. FDA scientists wrote the contamination most likely occurred during the multiple number of aseptic connections in the formulation stage. So let me ask you this question. Aseptic connections were identified as a potential source of contamination in 2003. They weren't fixed. They then were identified by both Chiron and FDA officials as a likely source of contamination in 2004. Doesn't that make the 2003 inspection and FDA's failure to follow up to make sure the problems were fixed relevant to the problems in 2004?
No. The bioburden comes in with the eggs, the chicken eggs that the virus is grown in, and it is discrete to that particular year. The bioburden of 2003 is long gone, and so you bring in a new bioburden with a new chicken eggs, and what you have to do is to reduce that load through various means.
Your staff met with our staff this week, and when they met, your senior FDA officials conceded that a number of the findings in 2003 were relevant to the 2004 problems. These included problems not only with the bioburden and the aseptic connections, but also with the basic sanitary practices in the facility. In essence, what they told us is that the problems identified in 2003 didn't get better, as FDA hoped they would. Instead, as production volumes increased in 2004, the problems at the plant expanded, ultimately leading to the shutdown of the facility. I would submit that this was a serious cost of the FDA failure to be more vigilant. If the agency had taken official enforcement action, as the FDA inspectors asked for, as they recommended, the problems at the plant might have been corrected and the flu vaccine crisis might have been averted. And if FDA would be more honest about what happened and the mistakes that were made, the public would have greater confidence that the agency will correct its mistakes and can be trusted in the future. Dr. Crawford, I know you want to say this is different, but essentially what we have is a plant that has had troubled sanitary conditions in its production, and those troubled sanitary conditions eventually led to the contamination of the vaccine supply. That's what caused the shutdown by the British. That's what your FDA people saw when they finally got out there. I would submit to you that now that we have these documents, it's not good enough to say, well, things were getting better. If they weren't getting better, the problems hadn't been corrected, the production was being increased, and with the increase in production and the facilities not having their sanitary problems corrected, we ended up with a breakdown.
Well, I had to condemn, as you know, the production for this year based on the fact that the bioburden could not be reduced this year, and that didn't happen in 2003. But it was one of the toughest decisions I ever had to make, but we could not allow that vaccine into the United States. We had to take that particular step, and we are working now with the British to see what can be done for the next flu season.
Well, you say it was a very tough decision for you to make. But in fact, it wasn't you that had made it. It was the British who shut down the facility and prohibited Chiron from selling any vaccine.
We already had between 6 and 7 million doses in the United States. We sent a team over to do an inspection of the plant, and then I had to make the decision. That's the sequence.
That was after the British action or before the British?
That was when the British notified that they were suspending the license. We already had the vaccine here in the U.S.
Well, the point is clear. The British suspended the license because these problems were contaminating the vaccine supply. You had some of the supply here. You decided you can't use that supply. The British had already shut down the plant.
Well,
you said that there was no relevancy to the June 2003 inspection to later problems. I just dispute that statement. You said that the FDA assured that Chiron took all steps to resolve the problems from 2003, but FDA had not done any reinspection of the facility. And your own inspectors found this to be untrue in October of this year, finding that a key issue involving contamination was not corrected since the previous inspection. All of these statements that I think were made by you and others in the administration that were not accurate had the effect of reassuring Americans before the election about the Bush administration's role in the flu vaccine shortage. Prior to the election, FDA withheld documents from this committee that revealed the truth. FDA ostensibly said that there was a reason to not send us the documents at the time we requested, because the individuals who were to produce the documents were too busy trying to find more vaccine. But when we looked at the fax cover sheets now with these documents, they were sent to you by individuals on October 18th, 2 days prior to our deadline, just as I had been informed by an FDA employee. So what I'm picking up here is a pattern of misleading statements and maybe even political calculations that I think reflect poorly on the administration, but I think they do an enormous amount of damage to the credibility of the FDA. I did want to get into the other enforcement actions that have not been followed through by FDA. We've seen just dramatic decreases in enforcing the law. I know you consider this a routine procedure.
But
this is not a routine procedure when you're talking about half the vaccine supply of the United States. Please.
Every statement I made was accurate. And as you know, the chairman granted us an extension of time so we could produce the documents that were requested all together and not just dribble them in. And so we complied with the chairman's timing.
How can you say, I just want to ask this one last question because my time has expired. How could you say there was no relevance for the inspection in 2003 when your inspection in 2004 had specifically noted on it by the inspectors that the previous problems had not been corrected from 2003, which have to do with contamination of the facility?
The problems were corrected because the vaccine production was good and could be used. They use the same terms, and that may be where the confusion is coming
in. Your inspector said that wasn't true,
if something happened like in 1999.
So you think the problem was correct? Gentlemen,
gentlemen's time has expired. Crawford, I want to give you an opportunity if you wanted to finish that, but I just.
No, I was just saying they use the same terms of art to describe inspections, you know, maybe over a 20-year period. That doesn't mean that whatever it is, like the bio burden, doesn't occur from year to year.
Well, let me ask, you could have taken the 99 inspection.
Absolutely.
And said that had a problem with 2004 as well, couldn't you, under the same logic?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, gentlemen, yield just on that point. We're not talking about something years before. We're talking about 1 year earlier, they told you there's a problem. You say they didn't show up, so it was corrected, but it didn't appear to be corrected according to your own inspectors.
I think you just explained it.
If it hadn't been corrected, I think
I've already answered that.
Yeah,
they were corrected.
I think he explained it, and I don't think we're going to reach a closure on this. Mr. Michael, you recognize for 5 minutes, and then we'll go over to
Dr. Crawford, don't you realize how many times you deny the accusation that it's still thrown at you? Dr. Crawford, this is this little exhibit here, warning letters for biological manufacturing violations, have dropped sharply since the fall of 2001. Actually, it goes back to 2000. Are vaccines considered part of biological manufacturing?
Yes, they are.
And hasn't there been a significant drop in actual manufacturers of vaccine?
Yes, we are down to only.
So if we have fewer people producing the vaccines, then we would have fewer people to go after. This is a great example of trying to now blame the bureaucrats, as I've said, and FDA. Now, FDA, you don't know it, but you're the fall guy. I've sat on this panel now for 12 years, and I've been through vaccine hearings over that period of time. And first, the folks on the other side They blame the drug manufacturers. These are bad people that they were producing bad stuff and they were charging too much for it. So then the next routine was, it's not just the drug manufacturers, well, it's those bad insurance companies because the cost went up dramatically. And I think I cited at the last hearing one vial someone held up and said, this only cost a dollar or two, the actual vaccine itself. But the insurance cost $20 or $30 if you could get it. Well, now we have no manufacturers in the United States, I guess, except for nasal vaccines. We have no insurers. So it's your turn to be the fall guy, and it's your fault. Don't you understand that? Now, you just heard that if you had gotten there a little bit earlier or sent a warning a little bit earlier, there wouldn't be any shortage. Is that correct?
I did hear
that. Well,
first
we go on the premise that you weren't there in time, which you've said you acted in an appropriate manner. But somehow, even if you'd acted a few weeks earlier, would we have a flu vaccine shortage today?
No, it wouldn't have had any effect because
okay.
They started this in January.
And you've made that point. But the root problem and cause, and a lot of folks in Congress don't want to admit it, are, as first of all, liability. It's kind of interesting that you had trouble getting to Liverpool to look at a manufacturer. I submit for the record this article from the International Herald Tribune that shows France, Germany, and Switzerland, for example, follow the so-called British rule, where the losing party pays the cost of winner's lawyer, and it goes on to describe how difficult it is in the countries where they're manufacturing flu vaccine, where you have to fly over and try to find out what they're doing, how much easier it is to produce that, and how much more difficult it is to sue and have lawsuits which have driven manufacturing out of the United States.
Would the gentleman ask that article be put in the record?
Oh, yes. I'm sorry.
Without objection, that the article
like
be entered
that
in the record.
In the record. So, one, we need liability and tort reform. Till we get that, folks, you're not going to have health care costs reduced. It's interesting. Pick up the papers today and see how in a couple of the papers, how many more doctors are closing down their operations, how many health care providers are going out of business or relocating their activities. And that will continue until you get some tort and liability reform in medicine. Regulatory reform, and it now takes some 8 months, and you've described the process. Oh, let me go back first. The accusation is maybe we haven't spent enough money, because you got to always spend a lot of money. NIH, that's Fauci, Dr. Fauci. In 2001, on research, we had a 10% increase from 2001 to 2002. I'm not very good at math, but that's what it looks like. Even before all this came out, I want to say we doubled. We went from 22.8, but 57.4, I'd say, is about 160% increase in research. So we did, so that goes out the window.
Gentlemen have a question. His time has expired.
Okay.
Okay, Mr. Waxman, you're
right. Well, I have a number of points and a number of questions. I'm willing to stay for a second round, but I'm trying to get at the root problem and identify liability, regulatory reform. And I have a host of questions about the states buying this, about guaranteed purchases by the government that have driven up costs. And I'll get to those when I have adequate time. Thank
you. Mr. Waxman, you recognize for 5 minutes.
Mr. Chairman, my colleague, Mr. Micah, didn't get to his questions because he was making absolutely incorrect statements about a lot of different things. He used the opportunity to say, we've all on this side of the aisle accused the manufacturers as being bad people. We've never said that. He's saying, oh, it's terrible. We're accusing the FDA bureaucrats of maybe not doing the right thing. He doesn't believe that. He thinks it's malpractice or liability issues that has caused the problem we face today. Well, I would submit that it was not the liability laws that caused the contamination of vaccine in Liverpool. It was the fact that they had unsanitary conditions there. And the inspectors from Britain found that out to be the case. And eventually, our own FDA came to conclude that that was the case. My criticism of FDA, and I don't consider Dr. Crawford or the FDA to be bad people, but my criticism is that the FDA didn't do enough to stay on top of this issue. They knew from previous inspections in the year before, 2003, that there were problems at that plant, and they never went back for another inspection until after the British closed the plant down. I disagree with Dr. Crawford's statement that it was irrelevant that they found there was contamination in 2003. He said there was contamination in 2003, but that wasn't the problem in 2004. His inspector said there was the problem in 2004 because it hadn't been corrected from 2003. Well, if you take Dr. Crawford's statement, it would have to be they corrected it, and then they went back into a contaminated state. That doesn't follow. Now, let me just address the liability issue, because that is really a red herring. The gentleman speaks with a great deal of ignorance, because in the liability area, vaccines were a problem. Manufacturers weren't making any vaccines for fear of liability. And we authored, I authored, and the Congress passed, the vaccine compensation system. It has been very successful by providing a fund to compensate those people who are injured from a vaccination. It's been very successful in keeping people from going to the courts. The flu vaccine is part of that vaccination system. None of the drug companies, none of the advisory committees to the FDA have come in and said we ought to change the immunization problem, liability for immunization, because it is not a problem in this case. I'll leave to another time to discuss the problems of medical malpractice, which I do think is a serious problem causing higher prices in the practice of medicine. I just think it's important, especially if this is on C-SPAN, I don't know if it is or not, but following his statements made with such abandon and such ignorance, I think somebody should correct the record. I do want to take advantage of the fact that I have my 5 minutes, and I thank my colleagues for indulging me to do this, but FDA has, I think, undergone a very serious change in direction in the way they have been responding to a number of the problems, not just in this area, but this area is emblematic of it. The page of the Well, we have a chart over there. It's the warning letters for biological manufacturing violations. They've dropped sharply since the fall of 2001. You can see in 1997 there were 17, in 98, 19, and then after 2001 there was 1, 2, and 1, a big drop. We've seen the warning letters to manufacturers who are making false and misleading statements in their advertising. They've dropped dramatically. I would submit that FDA is just not enforcing the law. I was concerned that they just didn't even enforce the food labeling laws, which I also had a part in authoring. Dr. Crawford, why do you think that's happening at FDA? Why is there a precipitous drop of enforcement actions?
Well, there are not as many people to regulate, not as many companies, as was stated earlier, but we have not lessened our profile in terms of evaluating these companies. And but there is variability. If you go it back, if you take it back a long period of time, you'll see that, you know, some years it's up, some years down.
Well, we
but
see
if we had, if we still had 20 manufacturers, it would be up higher.
Well, I'm not talking about just vaccines, but even for the false and misleading statements by all pharmaceutical companies in their advertising, an 80% drop in any kind of enforcement actions to be sure the public is not misled.
Well, we do have fewer drugs that are on the market that have prescription status and are still in patent also. So that would account for some of it. But we have not lessened our attention to this kind of activity.
Thank you. Gentleman's time has expired. Mr. Deal, recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Dr. Gerberding, thank you for being here. We appreciate the fact that you and the CDC and my state of Georgia are doing such a good job. I'd like to ask you just briefly, you have outlined what you have done in this rather critical situation of a shortage of the flu vaccine in terms of trying to make sure that it is delivered, what is available is delivered to the most critical places. What role, if any, would the CDC play in a normal situation? Do you participate in those decisions in the absence of a shortage?
Unlike childhood vaccines, the flu vaccine market is almost entirely in the private sector. So CDC only purchases a very small amount of the vaccine, and therefore we have only a limited capacity to target or direct our supply to the appropriate individuals. In the last 5 years of vaccine production, every year, vaccine doses have gone unused. So in general, the private sector distribution has targeted to the people who are willing to take vaccine. This year, of course, we're expecting the profile to be very different. What we do is work with our expert advisory committee, the ACIP, to make the recommendations, the science-based recommendations about who will benefit from vaccine and how they should be vaccinated and when they should be vaccinated, and then the adult immunization mechanisms in the healthcare delivery system and in the public sector at the state and local level kick in to actually administer it. This is one of the things that we're looking at is opportunities to improve our typical coverage of this vaccine, which has never been ideal. We would like to have a higher demand for flu vaccine, and we would like to assure that everybody who needs a dose gets it.
You mentioned something about the fact that it is fragile. What is the shelf life of the injectable vaccine? I assume it can't be frozen and preserved in that fashion. What is the shelf life for a vaccine?
With this particular vaccine, the shelf life, assuming that the cold storage is maintained properly, is not very relevant because the virus changes every year. And so the shelf life is longer than a year, but it doesn't help us very much because we need to make a brand new vaccine every single year. And that's part of the challenge that this particular infectious disease presents to us. It's part of why Dr. Fauci's comments about the need for modernizing the vaccine is so very critical. Imagine if we didn't have to get a flu shot every year. We would be in a very different situation than we are right now.
Right. There are obviously disagreements and opinions as to why we have so few manufacturers. Am I correct that one of the earlier statements that there is no domestic United States manufacturer of an injectable vaccine for the flu, is that correct? There is no American domestic producer?
Aventis is producing vaccine in America, but they are their headquarters are in France. So the actual manufacturing does occur in the United States for the product that we're using.
How long have we been in a situation of having only two major suppliers? How many years has that situation existed?
10 years ago, we had five suppliers, and there's been a gradual attrition over that period of time until just the two injectable suppliers this year.
You know, you would think normally the old adage of supply and demand would work in this environment. Obviously, that is not the normal forces are not at work here. And I would assume that there are some truths to the allegations that the issues of liability play a factor in the fact that we have so few manufacturers available. Is it simply not a profitable business? And perhaps the second panel is more appropriate perhaps to ask that, and we will try to ask it there. But from your perspective, is it the lack of profitability that is limiting the supply?
We have a few big problems. One is that we don't have a guaranteed market for the vaccine, and we have unpredictable demand. The second is the manufacturers need a fair price for the product that they're manufacturing. They need to have a business case. The third issue is that making this vaccine is risky, as Chiron discovered this year. This is a very difficult manufacturing process. You start out with a bioburden, and by the end, you're supposed to end up with a product that's sterile enough for use, and that's fraught with opportunities for things to go wrong. The liability has played a role. This is the first year that we have recommended flu vaccine for children, which makes it eligible for the Vaccine Injury Compensation Program. In past years, because we hadn't recommended it for children, it was not on the list for liability protection. And even that doesn't completely remove all of the concerns about liability. It only covers the things that are in the table. So it's a complicated set of problems, and the bottom line is the manufacturers need to know that they can make a strong business case for producing this vaccine.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
The gentleman's time has expired. Thank you. Mr. Van Hollen, recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for holding another hearing on this important issue. I want to thank all the witnesses as well. My first question is, you know, obviously this year we have to make the best of the situation that we got before us. We have to reallocate the existing vaccine to those people who are most vulnerable. My question is, what is the administration's plan, if any, to prevent this kind of shortage from happening next year and into the future? That's one question. The second set of questions relates to the issues that Dr. Fauci mentioned with respect to the avian flu and the pandemic, which is something obviously we need to be preparing ourselves for, not just as a nation, but as an international community. And my questions there are, number one, to what extent do we have cooperation from many of the Asian countries where this flu is originating that allows us to detect it early enough to prevent it from spiraling out of control to the point where we can't isolate it and it becomes a pandemic? And what recommendations, if any, do you have to make sure that we have an early warning system in place on the ground? I know a number of people at CDC have been working on this and have been frustrated by their lack, for example, of cooperation with the Chinese. So that's one set of issues, the early detection. And the second set of issues relate to a vaccine and whether or not we are moving ahead as quickly as possible in coming up with a vaccine, whether mutations in the avian influenza would defeat the work that we're doing. And even assuming that we're on the right track with respect to manufacturing a vaccine, what are we doing in terms of the production capability? Because we haven't prepared adequately to have a supply of flu vaccine where we know we've got certain strains of flu. At what time would we be prepared from the vaccine production point of view to confront an avian influenza pandemic? I know it's a lot of questions, but these are obviously big issues.
I'll start and then we'll pass the baton down the table. In terms of the scenario planning, worst case scenario planning for next year, our Team B is working on this from a CDC perspective. The Secretary has also called a special task force at the Department to really dig into what can we do now and what can we do soon to obviate this situation. One major thing is to work with the existing manufacturers to see what can be done to support the largest possible production, and Dr. Crawford has already mentioned that Aventis and MedImmune are looking at ways that they can increase their production next year. Getting Chiron back online is clearly a high priority for everyone. We may have vaccine available from international manufacturers on an IND, an investigational drug status, and that can allow us to get more doses in, and we're working out the mechanisms for that as we speak. And also, we will certainly focus on prioritization early in the season and make sure that we get the targeting when the first dose of vaccine is available, not waiting until more than half of it has been distributed as we did this year. So there are some short-term things we can do, but we really look forward to working with the administration, with Congress, to figure out if there are additional incentives to help expand the market and get the production up to where we need it to be.
Let me just extend that, Mr. Van Hollen, and talk about what we're actually doing right now in preparation for pandemic flu, and I alluded to it in my opening statement, but let me just summarize it briefly for you. We know now that there are a couple of circulating avian influenza viruses. The one that's causing us the most concern is H5N1. Another is H9N2, H7N7, a few others over the years. But let's just focus for the purpose of an example on H5N1. What we're doing now is we are assuming, and it may not be correct, but the assumption, I think, is an appropriate thing to do, because it'll set into motion the machinery that will prepare us if we have to switch in midstream. So we're assuming that the H5N1 is something that we need to worry about. So we're developing two things in parallel. The first are pilot lots. We've isolated it by that rapid method of reverse genetics, and we're in the process of making pilot lots in small amounts, 8,000 to 10,000 from two companies. And we're doing that in order to put them into the clinical trial to determine two things. One, is it safe? Because we have not vaccinated people with H5N1s. We assume it will be, because the methodologies essentially stay the same. And second, how much do you need to inject to get an adequate immune response? Is it going to be one dose, two doses, or more? So that's going on right now. In parallel, in the assumption that we'll have an H5N1 problem, we've contracted with Aventis Pasteur to get us 2 million commercial lot doses. And that's critically important, because the process that gets you the 8 to 10,000 doses is not something that you could scale up to 10, 20, 30, 40 million. But the 2 million of the commercial lot doses will set the process in motion that if indeed we do need to scale up, right, it's much easier to scale up. Now, on the scenario that perhaps the virus will change so much that the vaccine that we're making is not specifically going to target that virus that now is spreading efficiently human to human, the very process of scaling up with an avian virus vaccine is going to put us in good stead to go and meet that challenge. So we're already doing it now.
The gentleman's time has expired. At this time, your mic's not on.
The issue of international cooperation, trying, I know it was a big question, a lot to cover.
If there could be a quick answer, I'd be happy to entertain it, but not a long one.
Okay. I can give you a quick answer. We have a system called the Global Detection Network, and we're investing in laboratories around the world and scaling up our ability to get those isolates and get them to CDC for sequencing and onto the seed vaccine development process. We're also sequencing all strains that are coming in.
Technically, I'm next in line, but I notice we have a number of colleagues on the Democratic side of the aisle, so I'll defer my questions and go to you, Ms. Norton. I think you're next.
Thank you very, very much, Mr. Shays. Two questions. One has to do with the kinds of issues local jurisdictions are going through now, to think of what they can do now. I asked the District of Columbia Department of Public Health to use its authority to issue its own regulations in an effort to avoid panic, and because, as you know, most of the vaccine is in private hands and does not go to public health authorities. They did so. I want to know, as you know, every state in the United States, and this would also be the case in most cities, has the authority that you apparently don't have to proceed on its own to avoid a public health crisis. I want to know if you have asked public health authorities to use their own local authority to issue such regulations as they deem suitable, to advise them that that would be an appropriate thing to do in light of what you know about our supply and the delays that are already being experienced by local jurisdictions getting whatever supply is available. Have you asked those who do have authority to use their authority? For example, a private physician who has regular patients may well be under some very special pressure to give the vaccine to people who are not in high priority groups. It would be much easier for that physician to say, regulations indicate I can't do it, than to say that the CDC, who has no authority over me, said I can't do it. So I want to know, since you didn't have the authority, since you left us all out here, whether you have at least asked local public health authorities who do have the authority to use their authority.
We have indeed recognized the statutory authority of the state health officers as well as the local health officials to make decisions to protect their the health of people in their jurisdiction, and that is exactly why we have been able to provide them with the detailed information about their high-risk populations and the vaccines that are there.
I'm sorry, I didn't get the answer to my question. Has the CDC specifically advised local authorities that it might be beneficial, not saying that you should do it, but that it might be beneficial for them to use their own local authority to handle this public health crisis?
Yes.
Would you indicate to me whether that has been in a written directive? Could I get a copy of it? How was that advice given? What have you advised them to do specifically?
The state health officials have worked with CDC to develop the criteria for vaccine allocation. They are receiving the...
Yeah, see, you're not answering my question, and I have another question. So I know you've been working with them to develop the criteria. I've asked you something else. It has to do with their legal authority to issue their own regulations so that people know that you're not supposed to give these doses outside of the priority groups. Now, I'm not talking about developing and whatever. I'm saying very directly, have you said you've got authority? We're not sure what you'd want to do with that authority, but when you have a public health crisis, you should at least consider using that authority if you think that authority would help alleviate the crisis. I've given you the kind of circumstance I'm talking about, and I'm asking a direct question, and I want a yes or no answer.
Yes.
Or if not a no, and if a yes answer, then my follow-up question was, what did you say? Give me a copy of it. I don't know that my authority has received anything. At least they've not reported any such thing to me.
We'd be happy to provide you that information.
What did you say? I'm asking you a question here.
We said we encourage you to exercise your statutory authority to make decisions about vaccine allocation for your district. And we've also provided them with information from our public health law program, which gives them the legal guidance from the statutes
that
are applicable to them.
Well, that certainly is at variance with what I was told. Therefore, I'm asking by the end of the day, would you provide me with a copy of that? We were told that you all did not consider it appropriate to do so. And I'm very pleased if you have reconsidered.
We consider it appropriate for them to use their authorities as they see fit.
Well, obviously as they see fit. I'm not asking you to demand what you can't demand. I'd like to have a copy before the end of the day so I can make sure my own public health authority knows that has been your recommendation.
Time has expired and we need to move. Between Ms. Maloney and Mr. Sanders, have you worked out who goes next?
She won.
Okay. Ms. Maloney, you're next.
Thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank the witnesses for your testimony. And just to underscore how critical this challenge is, two flu outbreaks in New York City alone have led to the death of four people and 13 hospitalizations in the past few weeks. Our mayor, and I congratulate him for this action, has reached out to purchase, along with New Mexico and Illinois, 200,000 doses of flu vaccine from European suppliers. And while this is not enough to cover everyone in New York City, it would cover our high-risk residents, and it would supply roughly 570,000 doses of vaccine. I wrote a letter, along with other members of the New York delegation, in a bipartisan way, to Commissioner Crawford, asking FDA to expedite the process for the review for these doses. And I really want to know where that is. We need to get this vaccine. We have wholesalers that are available in Europe who will sell to us. And how soon can we get it approved?
We're going through a process which involves, first of all, getting the lot numbers of the vaccine, which the governors and the mayor have kindly provided. The company that manufactures the vaccine has authenticated those lot numbers. They are, in fact, legitimate production from their facilities. And what we're now doing is getting what's called the pedigree, and that is where the vaccine has been, whether it's been where it's been shipped to and whether or not it's been kept refrigerated. We should have all that information in the next few days, and we should be able to make a determination of whether or not it's suitable very shortly after that. Can't give you a specific date, mm-hmm. but we have up to 750,000 doses nationwide that we're dealing with, including the 200,000 for New York City, and we should be able to do all of them at the same time.
And I'd like to ask CDC, what is the justification that you have for not buying the many doses of vaccine that is available from wholesalers in Europe right now? And that vaccine is available, unlike the vaccine from manufacturers, which may not be available until January, which may be too late for many high-risk patients.
I think the answer is the same as the answer that Dr. Crawford provided, that we can't purchase vaccine until it's been verified that it meets the importation criteria and has been handled in a way. The vaccine in question has already left the manufacturer, so it's out in the wholesale arena, and we are not allowed to purchase that until we know that it's been properly stored and maintained and that its safety can be guaranteed.
So you are reviewing wholesale production and sale at this point, CDC?
But we're working with FDA to do everything we can to get international vaccine sources into this country safely and quickly.
I'd like to go back to the timing of the review. The Wall Street Journal this week quoted John Taylor, FDA's Associate Commissioner for Regulatory Affairs, and he said that in 2003, FDA's Liverpool inspection showed systemic quality control issues at the Chiron facility. And yet, even though you knew, or FDA knew, that they had these problems, you never returned to the plant to verify that things had been rectified and that the vaccine would meet minimum safety standards. And you relied on Chiron's assurances that they had corrected it. And even after Chiron announced on August 27th that it had identified a contamination in some of the flu vaccine, you still did not schedule an inspection. And so my question is, if FDA had responded quickly to the August 27th announcement, could we have avoided the severity of the problem? If you had gone in there early and worked with them and corrected it instead of waiting? And then secondly, if you had alerted Aventis, the second company that is verified to produce the vaccine, of the problem, could FDA have redirected their vaccine to the high-risk individuals? By the time the announcement came to Aventis that we had a challenge and that there was a shortage, they'd already shipped almost 60% of the vaccine. But it had not been shipped before August 27th. So in short, I think that the American people deserve more from FDA in their management, in a proactive way of making sure that the vaccine was there and checking on it in advance. But from this timetable that we have, you didn't even go for an inspection, you didn't follow up, you didn't alert Aventis. And then it comes the another question, why do we only have two companies with this vaccine? I shudder to think if it had been smallpox vaccine and we'd had a breakout of some terrible disease.
Gentlelady's time's expired. Dr. Crawford.
In any event.
Actually, we don't control how many companies want to enter the U.S. market. There's not much we can do about that. We wish we had the 20 manufacturers we formerly did. We did follow up on what we found in 2003. And actually, the vaccine for that year, which was the subject of that inspection, turned out to be okay, and it was used. Then a new batch of vaccine was prepared for this year, during this year. It was too late in August for them to start over again because it takes from roughly January, February, until it finally comes offline for it to be produced. So once we got the information, gone to other manufacturers, and we have been able to find millions of more doses, and we're still looking with the cooperation of governors and states and elsewhere to complete as large a quantity of vaccine as we possibly can.
Okay, Mr. Sanders, recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much. Mr. Chairman, the issue that I want to pursue is a very simple one, and that is the federal government and numerous states, including the state of Vermont. Mr. Crawford, Dr. Crawford, you and I chatted about this very briefly.
Yes.
And I discussed it with Secretary Thompson as well very briefly. They identified, the feds and the states have identified over 5 million flu vaccine doses that are available in Canada and in Europe. And we are not talking about, obviously, fly-by-night companies. We are talking about Aventis, we're talking about Glaxo, we're talking about ID Biomedical in Canada. And to the best of my knowledge, these flu vaccines have already been used and distributed in Europe and in Canada. It's not like a new product. My question is, given the crisis that we face, Mrs. Maloney mentioned that people in New York are already dying. The fear is that there could be a serious outbreak of flu. Why does it take so long? I mean, you have reputable companies in countries which are well regulated, Europe and Canada. You have a product which has already been distributed to the people in those countries. Why last month did you not send a host of inspectors there to make the check of the factory, if you want, of the plant, of the dosages, and get them out to the people? Dr. Crawford?
It won't take very much longer. The process is basically threefold. These vaccines, although used in other countries, are not approved for use in the United States. So we've got to speed up that process. The way we do it is we contacted these three manufacturers, got their production records, and also their master file of how they produce the vaccine.
That's the first day. And what did you do on the second day?
And the second thing is we sent inspectors, and they have now all completed their inspection of these facilities. They will file their reports with me.
I don't mean to be rude. We don't have a lot of time.
Okay.
I understand all that. That's legitimate. That's 2 days' worth of work. Why is it taking it a month?
No, it's about a month worth of work.
Why?
Because you've got to get these master files. You've got to get the cooperation.
We have things like email. You have planes
Let me explain. You've got to get the cooperation of the company. They first got to decide that they want to give it to us.
We have talked in Vermont to some of these companies. They want to sell their product. You're not giving me a good...
We've got to give them approval to bring it in under what's called an investigational new drug application.
I'll give you 3 days. This does not take a month. You have people in my state who are very concerned. All over this country, they're concerned.
I can assure you we'll get it as quickly as we possibly can.
All right. But you see, soon. I think I want to raise a question and tell me that maybe I'm being overly concerned here. Some of us, including a majority in the House, believe in prescription drug reimportation. We think that it is insane that Americans have to pay 2, 3, 5 times more for the same product that our friends in Canada and Europe do. If we had prescription drug reimportation, those products would be in this country a month ago. I hope very much that given the administration's opposition to reimportation, you're not making this more difficult than it should be. Could you comment on that?
If the question is, are we making it more difficult than it should be, the answer is no.
All right, but you still haven't given me a reason why, with all of the resources at the FDA's command, why we have not approved those medicines and why we have not distributed them.
Well, I've told you we're doing it as quickly as we can, and then it's a matter of days away before we make a determination about these particular products.
How long does it take you to make a determination?
Well, it depends on what the data is we get, how we evaluate it, whether or not we can...
Explain to the people who are watching this. You have a product that has been widely distributed in Europe and Canada. You're inspecting these facilities. These are major drug companies, above board, reputable. What is the how long is the determination going to take, and why is there so much question?
It's variable. It's normally about a month's time before we reach an evaluation because we've got to get all the records. We've got to visit the plant. We've got to make a determination. We've got to be sure that the vaccine brought in won't injure the American people.
Well, of course.
By law, it has to be done on an investigational new drug application, and that's the way it is.
But how long is this determination process going to take?
It's just about over.
All right. So you think you can make a decision fairly within a week?
I wouldn't be held to a week, but I think it could be quicker than that in one case.
All right. Now, my question is, mm-hmm. And I know you and I chatted about this, yes, and I talked with the
Time's expired. If you could state his question quickly, I think.
30 seconds.
State the question.
All right. Are you going to allow states and cities to go forward, or is this, are these European and Canadian drugs are going to come into the U.S. and you guys will distribute it?
We're working with the states. Some of them want to bring them in directly, and they already have made contacts, right, and so forth. So we'll work with them on an individual case-by-case basis.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah, let me, I could just follow up on it. I mean, you are at this point, I think you testified earlier, you believe that some of these drugs from foreign manufacturers are going to be certified and be able to come in the country.
Some of these vaccines, yes.
Vaccines, right. Thank you very much. I believe Mrs. Who's next over here? Mr. Tierney, have you had questions yet? I think you were here. Would you like 5 minutes? We still have a couple questioners here.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Crawford, let me ask you a set of questions here about Chiron's plant in Liverpool, England. It was subject to an inspection both by the FDA and by the British counterpart, the MHRA. Now, you've repeatedly stated that both agencies responded to the August 2004 reports of contamination in a similar fashion. I think at the committee's October 8th hearing, you said that both FDA and the MHRA performed inspections that were about the same thing. In a later press conference with Secretary Thompson, you stated, we would have, 5 hours later, made the same conclusions as the British. We were in synchrony with them. So I want to just ask about some of the differences between the British and the United States approach to that August Chiron announcement of contamination. When the initial contamination was reported, it was the United States and not the UK that immediately lost several million doses. It was the United States and not the UK that was depending on Chiron for about half of its vaccine supply. Yet it was the British who had, I think, much less at stake with this vaccine facility than did the United States, that sent an inspection team to the facility within a few weeks of the August 25 announcement, and the British, who also sent a second inspection team to the plant at the end of September. Why didn't our FDA respond forcefully to the August contamination by sending inspectors to the plants, as did the British?
We had inspectors in the plant on August 25.
And, but if I can just interrupt, you had somebody there by coincidence who was inspecting,
yes,
an entirely separate and discrete issue.
They were getting up a different line, right, and but they were there, and they were alerted by Chiron. They went over some records, made some recommendations. Subsequent to that, we and CDC arranged for a series of calls, at least once a week, to find out how they were doing with their bioburden in that plant. Things appeared to be going well up until the final reports, which came to the British and also came to us virtually the same amount of time. They scheduled an inspection, as did we.
But your inspectors over there did not do the same kind of thorough inspection that the British team did when it went in.
Can't speak for the British.
But you can speak for yours. I mean, you know that they did a more thorough examination. Your person did a somewhat cursory look at some records, but didn't actually have a full-flown inspection that you ordinarily would have had in response to this type of an emergency.
Well, we would have come to the same conclusion based on our lot release program. We would not have allowed the product into circulation. And I made that decision following an inspection that was took place on site.
Yeah. Let me look at another point of difference on this. The British received the draft of the Chiron inspection sometime in mid-September, before even their second inspection. Yet, on the other hand, we never received the report until the British actually shut down the facility sometime in October. How do you explain the fact that the British got that inspection report so much more quickly than the FDA did?
We were getting a weekly update from the company, and we were scheduled for the final report on October 5. The Chiron facility was under instruction from the U.S. government to quarantine the product, which they did, so none of it could be released, based starting on August 25. So I believe we had control. In fact, we did have control because none of it got out.
Yeah, but there was a serious gap, and the British seem to be on top of this thing. They're getting a report before their second inspection. We get it weeks later. I mean, it seems to me like they would be a lot more aggressive, even though they had less at stake than we did, and I'm wondering why it was that...
Well, we got a report every week, but the final report was scheduled for October 5 for both governments, because that was the end of the run. You can't get a final report until they finish.
Well, is it fair to say, though, that the FDA was caught a little flat-footed about the British closing of that plant, that the FDA didn't even know it was going to happen until after the fact?
Well, by law, they could not communicate with us, and we didn't, you know, and And we did not know that they were going to do that on October 5. No, that is correct.
The law that you're mentioning is a British law.
It is.
Right? But that can be waived. We know that because it was waived after the fact.
Well, the British issued a press statement about 3 days after the October 5 determination, which they said they were constrained by their law from communicating to us or the other 98 countries. And that's
but,
really
but it could
all
be waived, and it was waived after the fact.
Well, so now we're able to
you're sharing information now.
Of the company's willingness to share it.
So that's my question, I guess, is this. It's a very important source of supply for us.
Yes.
We had a lot at stake. Why would we rely simply on the company's analysis or report of facts or whatever? Why hadn't we asked for a waiver from the company, which tells us now that they would have certainly cooperated? Why didn't we ask for information from more than one source as this thing was developing? Why not say to the company ahead of time, we need a waiver, we want to not only find out from you what's going on, we want to talk to our British counterparts, and we want to have our own inspections, and we want to stay on top of this thing because we have so much at stake.
We were getting all the information we were asking from. There was no need to do that.
Thank you, gentlemen. At this time, Mr. Cummings, you have...
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I really appreciate it. let me just ask you this. I just want to make sure we're clear. Did FDA make any mistakes?
FDA is not perfect. We followed our situation here that as we traditionally do, and at the end of the time, we got the final report on schedule, October 5. We sent an inspection team over, and then we had to make the determination this vaccine was not usable, and therefore it never got to the U.S. population.
So you're saying that FDA made... excuse me. Are you telling us that FDA made no mistakes?
In this vaccine thing?
Yeah.
No, it never got on the market.
I can't hear you.
It never got on the market.
FDA rejected the recommendations of the inspectors and decided not to pursue official enforcement action against Chiron in June 2003. As a result, the problems at the facility were not public and told investors that the inspection showed the plant was really in very good shape, quote unquote. Was that a mistake?
That on the 2003 vaccine production, we asked them to make some corrections. They did. That vaccine was fine.
So you're saying you didn't make a mistake there?
No, because the vaccine was fine.
FDA failed to re-inspect the facility to find out if any of the problems were corrected or the company's plan was being implemented as proposed. Yes or no, was that a mistake?
We re-inspected by taking information from them all along, and so no, we did not
violate
our procedures.
So again, you didn't make a mistake. FDA declined to meet with Chiron after it requested a meeting, quote, as soon as possible to discuss plans to respond to the June 2003 inspection. This meeting could have helped the company understand the severity of the problems. Was that a mistake?
We met with Chiron.
FDA delayed sending a copy of the full inspection report to Chiron by 9 months from September 2003 to June 2004. By the time the report arrived, the time to implement some of the recommendations mentioned had already been passed. You didn't make a mistake again?
That was a mistake.
Upon hearing of the actual contamination of vaccine this summer, FDA neither conducted a prompt inspection nor reviewed the company's records. As a result, FDA was caught completely by surprise by the British enforcement action. Was that a mistake?
We did review the company's records.
So you no mistake there?
No.
You know, we got a major problem here. We've got people in my district who cannot get these flu vaccines that are begging for them. Seniors, many of them standing in long lines, but FDA made no mistake. The reason why I ask you these questions is that we cannot deal with a problem unless we accept the fact that we have one, that we made mistakes.
We're working to get more vaccines.
So FDA made no mistakes?
Look, the vaccine...
Yes or no?
The vaccine was contaminated in the final fill. There was no way to know that until October 5, when the final report came through. You can't do that until it gets finished.
So we
didn't make a mistake because we condemned the vaccine. It did not go into U.S. circulation. That was not a mistake. I would do it again.
So you're saying to the people of the United States as they watch you on C-SPAN that you all made no mistakes?
As I said, we condemned the
yes
vaccine,
or no?
And it did not get here. We make
no,
mistakes,
I'm talking about with regard to this.
We followed the procedures, and we took the right action.
No mistakes.
The vaccine didn't get into circulation.
Fine. Apparently, you don't want to answer my question. I asked you a question. I said, did you make any mistakes? Did FDA make any mistakes with regard to this? Sir, let me tell you something. I got to go back to my district, and I've got to explain to them why we've got a federal agency that, to me, made some mistakes, but refuses to admit it. At least give me, just tell me, just say no.
I already told you we made a mistake.
No.
We made a mistake.
You did. What were the mistakes that you made so that we can correct them?
We didn't get the report back to them on time in 2003. We were late by a few months, and it would have been if our procedures called for it to get there in time. We've corrected that procedure, but that was a mistake.
Let me ask you one last question. During the campaign season, I noticed one interesting thing that happened. Every time this flu vaccine came up in my district, my opponent jumped up and said, the companies are not producing it because they're not more companies producing it because they're afraid of liability. I heard that over and over again. The question is, and then I read in the Washington Post that one of the main reasons why they didn't produce it is because because it has a short lifespan and they were afraid of spoilage and losing money. Is that true? Which one is true?
I don't know why they don't enter the U.S. market. I don't know about liability. I think that could be a factor. But they have to remake the vaccine every year, and I'm sure that is a factor.
But you're saying you don't know why they don't enter the U.S. market?
Gentlemen's time has expired. Thank you. Dr. Crawford.
He said no. I just want to make sure that's on the record. He doesn't know why they don't enter the U.S. record.
Gentlemen's time has expired. And I don't think it's productive for members to be screaming at witnesses that are here on their own volition.
Chairman.
We all have questions at this. Now, I'm going to take my 5 minutes. The FDA basically followed your standard practices in waiting for the failure investigation report, right?
Yes.
Before proceeding to inspect the Chiron. And Chiron never did produce the report to you until after its license was suspended by the MHRA on October 4th.
That is correct.
The FDA and MHRA have both told the committee that Chiron had no reason to expect its license would be suspended until it completed its failure investigation report that was provided in draft to MHRA on September 24th.
That's correct.
Once Chiron's license was suspended on October 4th, U.S. access to the report and investigation by U.S. authorities was a moot point, although further inspection confirmed the judgment of MHRA. Is that correct?
Yes.
The problems at Chiron are not longstanding ones that FDA should have recognized long ago. Chiron's license was suspended for systematic problems in the facility, such as lack of oversight and execution, but not the specific contamination or other issues addressed in 2003, as you have stated and as we've gone through, and I think the reports are clear. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
The FDA didn't reject the initial recommendation of the team biologics to refer official action on the June 2003 issues.
No, we did not.
And further discussions resulted in full agreement by all of those involved that voluntary action was appropriate. Isn't that correct?
That's correct.
Was there any dissension in that after we sat down?
No, the team biologics has a very good peer review of the process, and then they reached consensus.
And there is no evidence that anyone involved in the process disagreed with the final decision, is there?
No, there's not.
Okay, I appreciate it. Mr. Mike, do you want to ask?
Thank you.
Well, I have I'm in my 5 minutes, Mr. Shays. Okay. I'll get 5 minutes. Mr.
Michael. You know, you've been hammered. You still haven't understood this because you're the bad guy, and you know, we got to prove you bad.
I'm beginning to get the picture, though.
Okay. But this 2003 mistake that you admitted to and not responding in time. Now, the batch of vaccine, when was that produced that proved to be bad? Was that in 2003?
That was with reference to the 2003 vaccine, which proved to be good, actually.
Okay. So the 2003 mistake that you admitted to had nothing to do with the batch in 2004?
Nothing, absolutely nothing.
Okay. Well, see, but you're bad, and you've got to pay, because we don't have the drug companies around. We have less people to... Pretty soon, you're not going to have anybody to send warnings to. What the hell are you guys going to do over there?
It'll be a lonely time for us.
But it is kind of sad that it has evolved to this. I think Mr. Van Hollen had a very good point, though. He's gone now, but
We do have lots of seniors that want that. We should be manufacturing this in the United States. And until we have liability reform, and Mr. Waxman is right, even though he attacked me personally, I have to say he's right. We don't have a liability problem now, because we've just about run out of people to sue. So he's right on one account, but you've got to address liability. Dr. Geberling, she went down all of the problems. You have a short shelf life. You don't have a guaranteed market, so people don't produce it. You have regulations that impede the production in the United States. You have a guaranteed purchase program of childhood vaccines that actually pays less than, I think, the cost, and that has also inhibited the manufacturing in the United States. So it's a host of these issues. And until Congress addresses these issues and changes some of the law regulations that we have in place, in fact, we won't be producing these vaccines in the United States. Just a quick question, Doctor. Wouldn't it be a lot easier for you to keep tabs on these manufacturers if they were in the United States rather than far-flung around the globe?
It certainly would be easier to get to them. We don't have any overseas locations at FDA. We have to dispatch our teams of inspectors from here.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And guaranteed purchases, Dr. Geberling, is that's also something that needs to be addressed?
I don't have the right formula for a solution, but everything is on the table right now. And in order to guarantee a market, that would be one strategy that we could look at mm-hmm. to assure the manufacturers that their vaccine would be purchased.
And the government now buys 60% of the pediatric vaccines. Is that still the case? That's the information that I have.
I believe that's correct, but I can get you the exact percentage.
Thank you. Okay. We're just about up.
Thank you.
And let me just add, I mean, we had an old saying when I used to practice law that if you have the facts, you pound the facts. If you got the law, you pound the law. And if you have neither, you pound the table. I think in this folk, it's pretty clear from the record that you have set out earlier today that you followed the appropriate procedures, you followed the appropriate protocols. We may need to tweak those protocols a little bit. I mean, we need to make sure what happened this year it should never happen again.
Absolutely.
And I think we need to have that dialogue or how best to prevent it. It seems to me that the most basic thing we can do is make sure there are more suppliers. And as Mr. Sanders and others have pointed out, there are foreign suppliers who haven't asked for U.S. Recognition, but we need to get them into our markets and have you out there inspecting them. And if we do that, at least we have some guarantee of alternate sources of supply. There are other issues we need to look at, but we'll talk about that. Mr. Shays has 5 minutes a little later, and we'll talk about that. Mrs. Watson has not had her 5 minutes yet. Diane's been patiently waiting over. Ms. Watson, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, very much, and thank you, Doctor, for being willing to sit on the hot seat. We're not going to talk about bad or good guys. I just would hope that you'd clarify some things for us. So I'm going to raise two issues, and then you can just address them together. First, and I understand that Chiron is based in my own state of California, yet we manufacture in the United Kingdom for the U.S. market, and I'm wondering why we could not start building a plant in California, why Chiron could not. That ought to be something that we ought to be talking to them about. And Adventis, I understand, is a French firm, but they manufacture in Pennsylvania. So is it possible to produce the supplies that we're going to need? And I will imagine our need will be greater in 2005 in California and Pennsylvania. You can answer that after I finish with my next comment. The next comment is that I understand in June of 2003, after the inspection, the company asked to meet with the FDA. And is it true or not that the FDA refused to meet with Chiron and to discuss its problems? And so can you clarify what's going on? It's essential, if they are one of two producers for the United States market, that we be communicating with each other. So can you clarify those issues for me, please?
Yes, we did meet with them. I've actually met with them myself, so that's not correct.
Can you give me a time?
We can supply that for the record, yes.
Has it been after 2003?
Yes. And with respect to the fact that there are no vaccine production facilities owned by American firms in the United States, I think what you, I believe Chiron is going to testify on the next panel, and you may wish to ask them. I think what guides them to seek facilities elsewhere is because the facility is available. In other words, I believe in mid-2003, Chiron actually acquired this plant from another company, and they didn't even own it until that point. The facility that's in Pennsylvania, I also believe, was previously owned by another corporation. So I think even though a French company manufactures there, it was because the plant was present. Now, what do we do about getting plants built in the United States? That's beyond my authority or expertise, but I would think what we're doing will help some, and that is we're engaging the CEOs of all the companies in the world that produce flu vaccine, and we're telling them that FDA has a commitment to help them get up line and get moving to either enter the U.S. market or to build a facility in the U.S. We'll help them with whatever we can do. We can't force them to do that, though, and that's why I responded as I did to the last questioner.
I think that as the Federal Drug Administration, and with the threat of maybe a biological war, a threat of biological vaccines coming in that are very toxic, I would think that the FDA would want to suggest that we have legislation requiring that we develop our own plants under the regulations that you already have. I see the need as being tremendous with the threat that is facing the United States and the rest of the world from the terrorists. I mean, we can't go through this, well, they didn't, you know. We need to be ready, and I would think that would be a readiness plan that would be recommended from the FDA. We should never find ourselves in this position again. And as Eliza Cummings said, we were getting called. I mean, people were coming into my office. I'm in the center of Los Angeles in tears. And they're rushing around to see if they can find a place to get their flu shots. And I'm telling them, don't get one. It probably will give you the flu because, you know, they do inject some of the, as I understand, the microbes. But please, please, as FDA, don't wait for us as the legislators to do it. You need to come with a strong recommendation, and we need to get the building of the plants and the distribution of these needed vaccines right here in the United States. Thank you, Dr. Crawford.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, may I just say
Dr.
one thing?
Sure.
I would just like to emphasize that the injectable flu vaccine does not contain a live virus that causes the flu. There is no risk of getting the flu from the vaccine. The nasal vaccine does contain a weak flu virus, and so there is a theoretical risk of getting flu from that product, but not the injectable vaccine.
Let me just respond by saying, regardless, I think they ought to be manufactured here, if it's the nasal or it's the injectable. We ought not to depend on other nations for our tremendous need.
I absolutely agree with you on that. Thank you.
Mr. Shays, recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank the gentleman. It's a wild circumstance. We have an American company whose product is made in England, and we have a French company whose product is made in Pennsylvania. And what I'm interested to know, Dr. Crawford, is if you had realized even 5 months earlier that we had a problem, there would have been no solution, or would we have been able to go out and requested vaccines from other places and been able to deal with this problem?
The eggs, which are chicken eggs, are actually...
I need a short answer.
It started too early, and so it would have been... We couldn't have done anything about it.
Right. So it speaks to a much bigger issue.
Absolutely.
I just want to align myself with Mr. Davis and also Mr. Micah. I mean, this is a huge problem, but the fault does not rest at your doorstep. It rests right here in Congress working with the three of you. I'd like to ask Dr. Gerbending, on October 25th, 2004, the CDC introduced a secure electronic system to display influenza vaccine dosage distribution information called the Flu Vaccine Finder. This data set is only available to state health officials. Has the Flu Vaccine Finder proven to be an effective tool for states to identify and reallocate available vaccines?
The Flu Vaccine Finder is an unprecedented way for states to see the proprietary information about vaccine delivery in their jurisdiction. I believe they are finding it to be extremely helpful. The feedback we've received so far has been enthusiastic, and with great relief, they can finally get their hands on the information about distribution planning that they need. We are working to make that same kind of information available to people at the local health department level as well. That just takes longer because there are several thousand of them.
Before asking the next question, I want to say that the imminent biological threat facing the United States, I think, is epidemic influenza. And the mutated viral form has caught the world unaware in the past, and it will do so in the future. SARS was a huge opportunity for us to see how we would deal with this issue. It was involuntary, and it was life-threatening, and it was extraordinarily serious. I think it points out persistent weaknesses in public health surveillance and vaccine production surge capacity to meet emerging threats. And I'd like to know if you agree.
I agree. But I also think that the investments we've made and the lessons we learned from SARS have been very helpful to us in dealing with this current flu season situation, and we are learning lessons from this situation that will help us be even more prepared for pandemic flu. In fact, that's part of our mission right now, is to look at the distribution process, to look at our detection capability, look at our surge, and make sure that we are learning from that so that if we see pandemic flu emerge, we can be better prepared.
So what I want to ask the three of you is, I'm asking, do we need a new mechanism, new incentives to guarantee that adequate number of safe and effective flu vaccines are produced and delivered annually, just in this more particular case? I guess the answer is yes. And then with the very short period of time remaining, tell me what that is.
One of the things from a research standpoint, very briefly, is to provide the advanced technologies to allow the companies to be able to get a head start, since we obviously have to partner with them to get the vaccine developed and out in an emergency situation. I mentioned a couple of them in my presentation, and that's one of the ways we can do it, by providing the technology through the science. That's one of several ways.
And provide economic incentives that they're willing to do that.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, and that gets to the point that you were making. There are four or five issues that we need to do. It's a risky business. It is not a high-profit business. We've got to not only provide the technologies that I mentioned, but some of the things that Dr. Gerbening early on mentioned and Mr. Micah questioned is something like guaranteed purchases, cutting down some of the red tape, which we call regulatory relief. And liability fits in there. It may not be the biggest one, but it's one of the several things we can do.
I agree.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. Well, let me say to this panel, thank you. Dr. Crawford, that's it. We don't have any more questions. I know you're sorry to hear that. You've acquitted yourself well. We, all of you have, and we appreciate you very much, your time, your expertise on this, and you know, you're no strangers to this committee. We look forward to working with you in the future as we consider these issues. Thank you very much. Committee, take about a 3-minute recess as we get ready for our next panel.
After the rest of this hearing, we'll go to the Senate for John Kerry's first speech on the floor since the election.
On tomorrow's Washington Journal, Congressman Mac Thornberry, Texas Republican, just back from a trip to Saudi Arabia, Iraq, and Afghanistan. and Skip Rutherford on the opening of the Clinton Presidential Library. More about that in a second. Also, Mary Agnes Carey from Congressional Quarterly on the FDA's oversight of the arthritis drug Vioxx, and Senator Kent Conrad, North Dakota Democrat, on legislation that would raise the federal debt limit. Washington Journal, live every morning at 7 Eastern on our companion network C-SPAN. The Clinton Presidential Library officially opens Thursday in Little Rock, and C-SPAN 3 will have live coverage starting at noon Eastern. President Clinton, along with Presidents George W. Bush, George H.W. Bush, and Jimmy Carter, will dedicate the new library and museum. Later Thursday night, starting at 10 Eastern on C-SPAN 3, a look back at other presidential libraries. The Clinton Library opening, live at noon Eastern, and Presidential Library tours Thursday at 10 p.m. Eastern on C-SPAN 3.
Later tomorrow, the Senate Armed Services Committee looks at defense spending. You'll hear from the head of the Government Accountability Office and controllers from different branches of the military. That gets underway at 3:30 p.m. Eastern, also on C-SPAN 3. Now back to today's hearing on the flu vaccine shortage. This last panel's just shy of an hour and a half.
Thank you. We're moving to our next panel. I want to thank our witnesses for appearing. Invited to join us in our second panel are two vaccine manufacturers to discuss vaccine production capacities to respond to the shortage crisis and ways to ensure a stable annual flu vaccine supply. Dr. Howard Pian, who's the President and Chief Executive Officer and Chairman of the Board of Chiron, will be providing testimony. We also have Kathleen Kohling of MedImmune, which manufactures the nasal spray vaccine FluMist, which was referred to earlier, and Dr. Robert Strube, who's the Virginia State Health Commissioner, also joins us. He's here on behalf of the Association for State and Territorial Health Officials to provide an assessment of state and local public health departments' ability to respond adequately to the vaccine shortage. And last but not least, Dr. Jerome Klein is here from the Boston University School of Medicine. He'll be providing a more academic perspective into issues surrounding the annual influenza vaccine. It's our policy that we swear everybody in before you testify, so if you'd rise with me and raise your right hand. Bill Solomy, swear the testimony you're about to give to be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Thank you. Let the record show everybody's here on their own volition. We appreciate very much your being with us today. I think you know the rules. Your entire testimony is in the record. You have 5 minutes to say whatever you'd want. I think you know when the lights come up. Dr. Pian, we'll start with you, and I know this has been an interesting six months or so for you, but we appreciate your working with us, working with our committee staff here and in London, and really, we're pleased to have you here. Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman Davis and members of this committee. I welcome the opportunity to appear at this hearing. In light of Chiron's strong tradition of commitment to global public health, our vaccine division's inability to provide influenza vaccine to the United States for this season has been a painful experience from which we're all learning a great deal. As we've said on numerous occasions in the past, we profoundly regret that we have been unable to supply influenza vaccine for this season. And we appreciate the opportunity to engage in these very important discussions. I respectfully suggest that the lessons learned from this year's experience provide an excellent opportunity to reflect on the critically important policy initiatives that the 109th Congress should consider to assure a reliable and stable influenza vaccine supply for the United States in the future. I'll focus my remarks on three key messages: what we are doing, what is our prospect, and what are the policy considerations that have emerged from this experience. First, Chiron Vaccines is proceeding expeditiously in implementing internal changes and devoting resources to enable it to regain its UK vaccines manufacturing license and to address the concerns raised by the FDA. In the past several weeks, Chiron Vaccines has developed a plan to implement a series of fundamental personnel changes that will restructure the management of our Liverpool operations. These personnel changes will leverage the strength of Chiron's existing global management team and will be supplemented by new management to help take us forward in managing the Liverpool facility. These changes will maximize our ability to enhance our prospect to meet the challenge of returning to influenza vaccine manufacturing for the 05-06 season. We have assembled a world-class international team of 70 internal and external individuals with expertise in quality control, quality assurance, manufacturing, and regulatory standards to conceptualize and implement a remediation plan. We have retained external consultants who have substantial experience with the U.S. and the U.K. regulatory standards. Most importantly, upon the approval of the implementation plan by our board of directors, this team will be empowered to make changes that will restore the confidence of our regulators, both here and in the United Kingdom. Also, effective November 3rd, I reorganized Chiron's senior management team to allow me to focus more attention on overseeing the vaccines division's remediation activities at Liverpool. To that end, I have appointed an interim chief operating officer of Chiron in Jack Goldstein, previously our president of the blood testing division. Starting November 4th, Jack began overseeing our operations other than those related to fluvirin remediation. To my second point, by devoting these resources to the remediation of our Liverpool facility, we expect to meet and exceed the required responses to the MHRA and the FDA observations raised in their respective inspections. Chiron Vaccines acquired the Liverpool facility in July 2003. Although both the regulatory community and ourselves recognized it was a somewhat older facility, we promptly committed to replacing the influenza vaccine production plant with a state-of-the-art adjacent facility estimated to cost $100 million, which is under construction. We also proceeded to address a number of the concerns identified by the FDA in its June 2003 inspection conducted when Liverpool was under previous ownership. At present, in coordination with both the MHRA and the FDA, we're close to finalizing a detailed remediation plan for our Liverpool facility. The plan covers a range of enhancements to our manufacturing processes, quality systems, and structure for management oversight. Subject to the concurrence of both regulatory authorities and approval by our board of directors, we will implement this plan expeditiously with the hope and the aim of supplying influenza vaccine next season. Our ability to regain our UK influenza vaccine manufacturing license in time to participate in vaccine production next year is mission critical for Chiron Vaccines. This plan addresses quality systems in a holistic manner and is proposed with the aim of exceeding the specific regulatory observations made last month by the MHRA and the FDA. The plan covers personnel, processes, equipment, systems, and infrastructure. The organizational changes will enable us to entrench a culture of quality where employee performance is correlated to clear and quantitative performance metrics. To successfully achieve its remediation objectives and to be able to provide influenza vaccine next year, extraordinarily close coordination between the MHRA and the FDA will be needed. In the meetings that we have held
with these regulatory authorities since October 5th, we are heartened by the encouragement we have received. Having said that, it is important to add two cautionary notes. In light of the broad and ambitious scope of our remediation plan, there can be no conclusive assurance that we will be able to meet the expectations of the MHRA and the FDA by March 2005, which will be the start of full-scale manufacturing season. Moreover, because of the regulators' GMP standards are ever rising, we cannot say definitively whether we will be able to meet them in future years. To my third and final point, this year's experience provided lessons that can enable us to strengthen our national public policies with regard to interpandemic and pandemic influenza. We know we must address short-term and long-term policy objectives that assure a stable supply of influenza vaccine, that drive uptake for vaccine, and that establish manufacturing capacity within the United States. In the so-called normal influenza season, a stable vaccine supply for the U.S. market is dependent on diversifying the manufacturing base, which is in turn driven by an environment conducive to multiple manufacturers. This environment should have the following characteristics. One, sufficient demand to enhance production capacity. Two, pricing and reimbursement that justify investments in maintaining and expanding existing production capacity. Three, a regulatory pathway that fosters innovation in new technologies. And fourth, mechanisms to reasonably protect vaccine manufacturers from liability claims. Market demand for influenza vaccine is dependent upon an effective public and private partnership that improves vaccination rates by raising awareness, dispelling myth, and extending the immunization season. In the long term, in order to effectively address our public health needs in the event of a global influenza pandemic, a strong public-private partnership is paramount, particularly to prioritize and allocate influenza vaccine in the event of a supply challenge. The essential ingredients for meeting this challenge are evident: information sharing, partnership, frequent communication, and hard work. The public health system's coping with the challenges, and I believe will emerge stronger from this experience with a clearer focus on strengthening our influenza immunization infrastructure and creating a sustainable influenza market. The men and women of the public health service have demonstrated incredible leadership in addressing public distress and in getting vaccine to those who need it most in the current supply shortage. With that as a backdrop, to increase manufacturing capacity in the U.S., the government should begin now to invite additional manufacturers into the U.S. market and to provide appropriate financial incentives and clear regulatory guidance. Experience teaches us, as you said, Mr. Chairman, that establishing this capacity likely will take several years. However, events occurring with regard to the avian flu in the Pacific realm indicate that the pandemic clock is already ticking. Thus, we cannot afford any delay. I ask respectfully that my written testimony be also included as part of the record. I'm prepared to answer more questions.
Without objection, the entire testimony of all of you will be a part of the record. Dr. Kohling, thank you for being with us.
Good afternoon. My name is Dr. Kathleen Kohling, and I'm the Senior Director of Regulatory and Scientific Affairs at MedImmune. a Maryland-based vaccine company that manufactures the innovative intranasal influenza vaccine, FluMist. Approved by the FDA last year for healthy persons 5 to 49 years of age, FluMist is the first advancement in influenza prevention in 50 years. We are at a critical juncture in defining what the influenza vaccine market will look like in the future and how U.S.-based vaccine manufacturers will meet the needs of this country going forward. What will be the incentives for companies to build U.S.-based manufacturing facilities? How will our government drive vaccine acceptance, utilization, and demand, since it is demand that ultimately determines the supply of vaccine manufactured? And what will be the incentive for continued innovation? MedImmune recommends that this committee support and encourage two key longer-term solutions in the realm of policy changes and incentives for innovation. The first recommendation is to move toward adoption of a universal recommendation for influenza vaccine for all Americans. The current recommendations, which are based on age groups and an ever-expanding list of underlying chronic medical conditions, are both complicated for the healthcare provider to follow and are confusing to the public. We believe that a universal recommendation will stabilize demand for vaccine, thereby leading to increased vaccine supply and ultimately to substantially lowering the current morbidity and mortality due to influenza. As an interim step, MedImmune recommends required vaccination of school-aged children who have a very high influenza attack rate and spread influenza to younger siblings, their parents, and their grandparents. Thus, vaccination of school children would directly benefit not only the children themselves, but may also have the potential to greatly reduce the impact of influenza in our communities. This concept of protecting an entire community by vaccinating the school-aged children has already been demonstrated in Japan and in studies in the U.S. In conjunction with this interim step, money must be appropriated to expand the education of the public and the medical community about the seriousness of influenza and the value of influenza prevention. The second solution that MedImmune recommends to ensure continued influenza vaccine supply is to provide tax incentives for scientific innovation and for construction of U.S.-based facilities. MedImmune is a primary innovator in the area of molecular techniques termed reverse genetics. The use of reverse genetics is vital to producing seeds for an H5N1 pandemic vaccine, as we heard from Dr. Fauci earlier. MedImmune owns multiple patents in this area and has granted free access to its reverse genetics intellectual property not only to governmental organizations, but also to other companies who are developing pandemic influenza vaccines. MedImmune is currently collaborating with the National Institutes of Health to produce intranasal pandemic vaccines and to test them in clinical trials. MedImmune also has core expertise in the innovative area of cell culture manufacturing. The main advantages of manufacturing using cell culture are elimination of our dependence upon egg supplies and more consistent and rapid production, which will be critical in the event that the egg supply is decimated by the emergence of a pandemic virus. The transition from egg-based to cell-based manufacturing will require considerable investment in the construction of new facilities and potentially additional clinical studies. Tax incentives to subsidize the cost of such innovations are necessary to guarantee a more stable vaccine supply on a yearly basis and when the pandemic comes. The government also needs to incentivize manufacturers to build manufacturing facilities within the U.S. There is an increased risk that with offshore manufacturing, companies will face political decisions that may prevent vaccine products from entering the United States, particularly in the event of a catastrophic pandemic. Tax incentives for U.S.-based manufacturing facilities would encourage manufacturers to build more facilities in the U.S. To address what MedImmune has done during the current vaccine shortage since October 5th, we have worked diligently with the appropriate authorities to first blend and fill our excess bulk vaccine to produce an additional 2 million doses of FluMist, bringing our total production for this year to 3 million doses. Secondly, we've supplied the Department of Defense with up to 400,000 doses. the CDC with 125,000 doses, and we've supplied hospitals with over 60,000 free doses of FluMist this year. Third, we've supplied the FDA with new storage data for FluMist, which they've promptly reviewed and approved, allowing the additional 2 million doses of FluMist to be stored in a household freezer without the requirement for the special freezer box. And finally, we've worked closely with the CDC and the Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices to clarify that FluMist is an option for all healthy people 5 to 49 years of age who want to consider protecting themselves from influenza this season. Shifting gears a bit and looking forward to next season, you must understand that the influenza vaccine manufacturing campaign for the 05-06 season is starting right now. We are already preparing the new vaccine seeds that we anticipate will be in the next year's vaccine, and we're making decisions about how many doses of vaccine we'll manufacture, including deciding how many chicken eggs to order. Thus, the amount of FluMist that will be available next season will soon be fixed. With some additional regulatory cooperation, MedImmune has the capacity to produce between 8 to 10 million doses for next season. These regulatory actions include FDA approval allowing for the production of larger lot sizes and filtration, acceptance by the FDA of our application to permanently eliminate the requirement for the FluMist storage box, and finally, FDA acceptance of recently submitted data that supports the expansion of the FluMist indication to include the 30 million healthy Americans who are 50 to 64 years old, a group that is not eligible for the injectable flu shot this season and may not be eligible again next season should we experience a continuing shortage. In summary, MedImmune is clearly at a crossroads in determining not only how much FluMist will be available next season, but also whether our investments and innovation will be recouped in this market. Our level of production for next season depends on the occurrence of several immediate regulatory actions. But whether MedImmune expands its production and whether companies continue their efforts to develop influenza vaccines depends in large part upon the government's commitment to encouraging innovation and driving demand. Requiring childhood influenza vaccination as an interim step toward a universal recommendation and legislating tax incentives for both scientific innovation and U.S.-based manufacturing will go a long way to ensuring an adequate supply of influenza vaccine in the near future. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony, and we'll hear now from Dr. Robert Strobe, Virginia State Health Commissioner with the Association of State and Territorial Health Officials. Welcome, sir, and you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Distinguished members of the House Government Reform Committee, my name is Robert Strobe. I am the Health Commissioner in Virginia. I'm honored to be testifying before you today, and I would like to thank you for convening this hearing on this really crucial problem that we're facing. The ongoing flu vaccine shortage continues to present many challenges for Virginia as well as the other states. State and local health departments have been working nonstop since October 5th to address this issue. As of today, Virginia Health Department has received a total of 159,565 doses of flu vaccine, which we've distributed to our local health departments and our long-term care facilities for administration to people at high risk of complications from the flu. In addition, the health department has received 84,480 doses of flu vaccine intended for high-risk children who are eligible for the Vaccines for Children program. According to recent information from CDC, we are expecting another shipment of about 150,000 doses, which we will allocate to long-term care facilities, hospitals, and other health care facilities with unmet vaccine needs. The health department is now providing the flu vaccine to many more people and providers than we would during a typical flu season. You might say that the health department is now the broker in the management of the flu vaccine to help ensure that the vaccine goes where it is most needed. We applaud the reallocation efforts of CDC and of Aventis, and we're grateful for the timely receipt of the vaccine we have. We firmly believe that as the Public Health Agency for Virginia, it is our responsibility to guide the allocation and distribution of vaccines to those who are most in need. However, we do want the community to be aware of the immense workload this situation has placed on local and state health department personnel. During the first week of November, the State Health Department distributed more than 77,000 doses of vaccine to our 35 local health districts on a population-based formula. Each health district developed a flu vaccine distribution plan based on the needs of the high-risk persons in that community. In developing those plans, all the health districts had to make difficult decisions on how to distribute the limited amount of vaccine. In some areas, they opened up phone lines and began taking appointments on first call, first serve basis. Some distributed the vaccine to healthcare providers in the community. Some pre-identified high-risk individuals who were unable to get the vaccine in the private sector. In Chesterfield County, just outside Richmond, the health department there held a drive-thru flu clinic this past weekend so that high-risk people wouldn't have to stand in line out in the cold. That one clinic required 120 staff members to manage all the logistics. The health director there estimates this ongoing issue has required more than 600 hours of work from senior level managers, supervisors, and other personnel. The health department's time devoted to this ongoing flu shortage supply issues means time away from other important public health practices. Another example is our ongoing distribution of 82,000 doses of vaccine to long-term care facilities in Virginia who did not receive flu vaccine. In order to accurately determine which facilities still need vaccine, all of our 35 health districts surveyed each facility in their community. The health department usually does not provide flu vaccine directly to long-term care facilities. Most of these facilities ordered their vaccine this year through a distributor or directly from the manufacturer, and most ordered through Chiron vaccine. In our immunization program, we typically only need one full-time person working on the flu vaccine program. This year, we have four staff persons working continuously on managing the issue at the state level. In addition, the issues require the involvement of all our senior level management, our public information personnel, and some of our emergency preparedness personnel, which manage state level planning, logistics, communication, and coordination. We owe a tremendous amount of gratitude to hardworking and dedicated public health employees who are spending hours planning and executing flu vaccine clinics or answering phone calls from our worried elderly and our other high-risk citizens. I would like to take this opportunity to personally thank each and every person for their service to our citizens. At the beginning of the shortage, one of our biggest difficulties was determining how much flu vaccine was available in the private sector. We would like to thank CDC and Adventist for their efforts to make this information about vaccine distribution in the private sector available to us through a secure web-based database. This information has helped us to identify geographic gaps in vaccine supply and focus our distribution efforts to providers in those areas. This system is constantly being upgraded, and just this morning before I left to come here, we found out that they've now upgraded it, so we will be ordering our vaccine directly and sending it through reallocation out over this database. Even with all the flu vaccine now coming to Virginia, we do not expect that we will have enough vaccine for every high-risk individual in Virginia this year. To help alleviate the situation, we continue to provide the public with useful tips for preventing the spread of flu in the absence of vaccine, such as frequent hand washing and staying home from work when sick. In addition, we have been encouraging the use of pneumococcal vaccine among the elderly and individuals with chronic medical conditions. This widely available vaccine can help prevent pneumonia, which in many cases is a secondary complication of flu. We'd like to thank CDC and the Department of Health and Human Services for all the work they have done to help manage the situation and secure flu vaccine for the state health departments. We believe that everyone involved at the federal, state, and local level has done an outstanding job addressing the problem. But I cannot stress enough how important it is for Congress to take steps now to prevent this flu vaccine shortage from occurring again. This situation has required an enormous amount of time and effort to manage and has had a major fiscal and human resource impact on other important public health activities. Efforts must commence now at the national level to ensure a stable flu vaccine supply. As many of us have stated in previous testimony, the present system of vaccine production distribution is incapable of effectively and efficiently responding to the current demand for flu vaccine. It is imperative that Congress take steps now to support development of a more reliable and flexible vaccine production and distribution process. In addition, efforts need to be made now to guarantee an ample supply of flu vaccine from multiple manufacturers. Given the estimated 36,000 people that die each year in the U.S. from the complications of flu and the threat of a flu pandemic, I believe addressing the flu vaccine production and distribution problem has to be of the highest priority for Congress. Thank you.
Dr. Klein, thanks for being with us.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I'm Jerome Klein, a pediatrician, a professor of pediatrics at Boston University, and a member of the National Vaccine Advisory Committee. A robust domestic vaccine capability is a necessity, not only for old threats such as influenza, but for new and virulent microorganisms spread by natural means or by bioterrorist activity. The current shortage of influenza vaccine underlines the vulnerability of the supply of all recommended vaccines in the United States. And I'd like to touch on four areas that have already been discussed in part in the prior discussions. First, the loss of vaccine manufacturing capability in the United States. Second, the issue of stockpiling. Three, Food and Drug Administration regulatory practices. And fourth, the liability concern. First, loss of manufacturing capability. Vaccine manufacturing is complex, involves uncertainties that do not exist in pharmaceutical drug manufacturing. There's no question that additional influenza vaccine manufacturers this year, if available, would have diminished the effect of loss of the Chiron product. Companies leave the marketplace when a product no longer provides a reasonable return on investment. Appropriate incentives must exist that encourage companies to enter and remain in the vaccine business. What is needed now is a sustained effort to provide concrete proposals that will have a durable effect. A multidisciplinary group to include all stakeholders should be convened to evaluate and propose appropriate incentives for manufacturers to assure supply of existing vaccines and stimulate development of new vaccines. And that is the encouragement of domestic vaccine producers not seeking vaccine overseas. Second, the issue of strengthening vaccine stockpiles. A program to stockpile vaccines has been available since the 1980s. The principle is simple. Government purchase of vaccine provides a repository that can be called on if there is an emergent need. Subsequent to the 2002 workshop held by National Vaccine Advisory Committee, there was additional funding that was provided to expand the stockpile program. However, no new vaccine has been added because of a Securities and Exchange Commission accounting regulation that bars vaccine manufacturers from claiming sales to the stockpile program as revenue until they come out of the stockpile. This impediment to a universally approved response to enhance vaccine supply should be remedied as soon as possible. Because a new influenza vaccine is prepared each year, the stockpile concept is not applicable. Rather, a redundancy of supply has been suggested. The government purchase program would be expanded so that additional vaccine beyond that required for patients at risk would be instituted. Since influenza immunization would be of value for healthy children and adults, the additional vaccine would not be wasted. Three, streamlining the regulatory activity of the Food and Drug Administration. The current good manufacturing practices need to be dynamic, with changes to maintain or improve facilities to current standards, but allow sufficient flexibility to ensure continued vaccine production. In addition, a review of current GMP and regulation should be instituted to consider whether the complexity of manufacture of vaccines and biologics warrants a separate and different mode of regulation than that used for drugs, which is the practice currently. Finally, the liability issue, which, as I understand it, has little role in the current concern about the contamination issue at the Chiron facility. But there is renewed concern about litigation associated with the manufacture and administration of vaccines. The National Childhood Vaccine Injury Compensation Program was established in 1986 to compensate quickly and appropriately individuals who suffered serious injuries associated with the administration of an FDA-approved vaccine. The program removed the threat of liability from the manufacturer as well as those who administer vaccines and successfully stabilized the market. The VIP should be maintained and strengthened to include additional vaccines. When those additional vaccines are added, additional staff will be needed. So the VIC program needs to be supported. Strengthening the VIC, VICP would benefit manufacturers, providers, consumers and further safeguard the nation's vaccine supply. The development of safe and effective vaccines during the past 50 years, since the introduction of the polio vaccine, has been one of the great success stories of American medicine. However, there is concern, as has been discussed today, that future contributions of the vaccine industry may be jeopardized by lack of attention to basic issues. Solutions are not easy to come by, and a sustained effort, the collaboration of all stakeholders, and political will be required. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, and thank all of you for your testimony. Let me just, if I could recognize, we have with us today in the back of the room, Cub Scouts Pack 1134, Den 7, from the Chain Bridge District. And we're happy to welcome you here today to today's hearing. This is on the flu vaccines in the United States and the shortage we're having. Let me just start with one question before I recognize Mr. Micah. And this goes really, Mr. Pian, could you tell us what happened at Chiron's Liverpool facility that ultimately led to the October 5th, 2004 license suspension?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Chiron, as I testified, acquired this facility in July of 2003. And the acquisition actually was conditioned upon a successful, satisfactory inspection that took place in June of 2003. And after we made the acquisition, of course, we continued the investment program. So about another $15 million had gone into this current facility since then. In addition, we recognize that as the standards of quality will be rising, that we need to build a new facility. And therefore, we made the commitment of spending $100 million, as I testified, to build an adjacent facility, of which roughly $30 million have now been spent. We had a terrific 2003 season, as Commissioner Crawford had indicated. We had a 40% increase into the U.S. market from that facility over 2002. We had a 30% total output increase, some of which, of course, went to parts outside of the United States. We found that the facility was viable. We had tremendous confidence in the ability for that facility to continue to produce products. And, of course, you will recall, last year, this time, when we're sitting here thinking about the regionally severe and earlier flu season, so there is indeed demand in the U.S. So that takes us into 2004. In July of 2004, our quality assurance programs identified two non-sequential batches which failed our standards, and they turned out to be sterility problems. We then formed a team to identify the root cause. In late August, I was advised that we would likely be delaying the shipment of Fluvarin relative to our previous release forecast. We immediately informed both regulatory agencies, MHRA and the FDA, of the expected delay and our adjusted forecast of supply. This incidentally led to a press release in August. Since then, we have been in regular consultation with both agencies to update them on the progress of our confirmatory testing program. And it brought us now to September 27th. On September 27th, our internal testing program concluded favorably. We expected, therefore, to be able to supply between 46 and 48 million doses to the United States. We initiated a process of reporting the outcome of our confirmative testing program to the regulatory agencies, starting with the MHRA. The MHRA came to visit our Liverpool facility on the 28th of September to both evaluate our confirmative testing findings and to start what was then what turned out to be a three-day inspection. When the inspection was completed on the 30th of September,
We received a one-page list of observations, and we responded to those observations 4 days later over the weekend, and that took us to October 4th. On October 5th, the MHRA advises of their decision to temporarily suspend our Liverpool plant license. And as a consequence of that decision, our products that were produced, that were tested, that were retested, could not be and were not released to the marketplace.
Thank you very much, Mr. Rankin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Dr. Klein, thank you for your very succinct and direct recommendations as to what we need to do to get flu vaccine and vaccine manufacturing in the United States. You covered incentives, which were also mentioned by the producer of the flu mist. You talked about stockpiling a bit. You talked about two things that I got into. I didn't have a lot of time, but regulatory reform and liability reform. The other thing that, Mr. Chairman, that I think he brought up too is a meeting of stakeholders. These hearings are nice and they make nice fare. Tomorrow it'll be a great headline that bashed the hell out of FDA and they were, but it doesn't get flu vaccine or other vaccines that are essential on the market. But a stakeholders meeting would be very good where we had people who actually manufacture and produce this, maybe with some of the FDA folks. I think, Mr. Chairman, that would be an excellent recommendation. And actually, the Virginia Health Representative said that Congress needs to take steps, and we do need to take steps. We're already into another season. But you pointed out something, too, and you know, I'm a fairly ignorant member of Congress, as has been pointed out here, but you did you did highlight one area that I'm not that familiar with, and that's the difference between regulation of a pharmaceutical and a vaccine. And maybe it is time, as you pointed out in your testimony, that we re-examine the regulatory regime we have. So I think that, and that may be out of the purview of our committee's jurisdiction, but it's one of the things that we haven't looked at, and you might want to address it. You probably share my ignorance in thinking that liability or the threat of liability, if we could remove that, would also enhance manufacturing. But I guess we're both probably of the same school and lacking in knowledge. I think you hit the nail on the head, Doctor. It's too bad you're the last witness, but I think everything you pointed out succinctly, again and directly, identifies the problem and where we need to go. So I thank you for that. Do you think the stakeholder, how would you compose a stakeholder conference or meeting? I think we should do that sooner rather than later, but give us your idea so we could do something positive and Congress must act Dr. Strobe has
Well, I think your remarks are very appropriate in the sense that you'd like to see action and you'd like to have the knowledgeable people who are involved, and that would include not only manufacturers but purchasers, consumers, legislators or legislative staff. Convene a session that would have concrete proposals as the goal, and then to bring those proposals to this committee or any other body for review and potential action. But I think as a citizen without legislative background, I think we need action. We want to propose that be moved forward as expeditiously as possible. And I think, in a way, the flu crisis that we have now is an opportunity to light a fire, because what's coming, it may be much worse. I think.
And Mr. Payne, he talked about the pending.
Because the pandemic flu problem is inevitable. It's not a question of whether.
It's when.
It's a question of when.
The final question, again, you have to excuse my ignorance. I'm not very knowledgeable about some of the regulatory process. But again, the point that you raised about treating vaccines differently from pharmaceuticals, and again, I'm not an attorney like some of these folks up here. I'm just sort of a leftover businessman. But the question I would have is, from a technical standpoint, does FDA have the authority to make those changes in that regulatory distinction, or is that something that would require a change in the law?
I'm not sure, but I think FDA.
Oh, another ignorant guy. I'm sorry. Well,
but I think they do have the regulatory authority to modify.
But I think that's an important question too that we should look at. Maybe
that's
we
correct.
Need to address. Thank
I think
you,
they
Mr.
can
Chairman.
Modify their.
Thank you.
Inspection.
Thank you,
Mr. Waxman. You're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Pinn, when FDA inspected the Liverpool facility in June 2003, the agency found 20 serious areas of concern. We now know that the inspectors believed that official enforcement action, such as a public warning letter, was justified. Had a warning letter been issued, the agency would have detailed the changes necessary to fix the problems identified. But a warning letter was never sent. The inspector's recommendation was downgraded. As a result, Chiron never received from FDA a specific list of changes needed to fix the problems at the June 2003 inspection. That raises the question of whether Chiron, which was in the process of taking over the Liverpool facility, really understood what was needed to resolve these concerns. On June 27, 2003, Chiron wrote to FDA asking for a meeting, quote, as soon as possible, end quote, to discuss the company's response to the June 2003 inspection. Would this meeting have been an opportunity for the company to learn more about what steps were needed to correct the problems at the facility?
Mr. Waxman, as I testified before, the inspection took place in June of 2003. And the Liverpool facility was then not owned by Chiron. It was owned by an English company called Patterject. Our board of directors conditioned the acquisition of the Liverpool facility on what was reported to us to be by the people in Liverpool, what was reported to us to be a satisfactory FDA inspection. I think that most of the correspondence that arose from that inspection still had the Evans letterhead on it, which was the name of the previous owner relative to the Liverpool facility. Since then, my understanding is that there had been discussions between ourselves, between our people in Liverpool and the FDA, relating to the observations that they made in 2003, prior to our taking them over. And as I testified before, Chiron made a very, very conscious decision that indeed we want to remediate against any past observations of deficiencies. And that was the reason that we followed through with a remediation program that went into that facility of $15 million that we've since spent, in addition to the new facility that
you
I talked
also-
about.
On the same basis, I assume, as for the meeting with the FDA, so you could find out what they knew about the plant that you needed to correct.
What I understand, Mr. Waxman, is that those conversations did take place. The regulatory contact were based in Liverpool, and those conversations did eventually take place.
FDA told us that they never followed up with you. So you have a different view of what happened, that FDA did follow up with about the June 2003 inspection?
Mr. Waxman, what I understand, what I'm told, is that around September or October, there was a telephone contact for our people to understand how best to proceed with the observations that were made in the June FDA inspection in 2003.
A year later, in June 2004, Chiron wrote FDA again asking for a full copy of the final inspection report. While this report does not contain formal recommendations for action, it does contain a number of specific details, including some recommendations that are not included in initial lists of agency observations. Now, according to the FDA staff, this full inspection report should have been delivered to the company in September of 2003, but because of confusion within the agency, it was sent 9 months later. I heard that Dr. Crawford even accepted, in response to a question from Mr. Cummings, that this was a mistake. Can you explain the difference in the point of vaccine manufacturing cycle between September 2003 and June 2004?
I have not seen that document, so I'm not sure. Mm-hmm. I should probably study that document such that I can provide an intelligent answer.
Well, if you get a chance to do that, we would welcome your comments for the record.
We shall.
Would having the full inspection report 9 months earlier have helped the company understand the FDA's June 2003 inspection better?
Congressman, as I testified just now, I understand there to have been a contact between our Liverpool-based people who were charged with the fulfillment of the remediation against the 2003 inspections, and my understanding is that that contact did take place.
The documents we released today showed the FDA's regulatory approach from June 2003 to October 2004 was to rely on company representations rather than conduct its own inspections to make sure that problems were being corrected. For example, after you announced a problem with contamination in August 2004, FDA chose to rely on a series of conference calls with you into October. But this approach did not work. From the end of August until the British shut the facility, you were telling FDA and the public that the contaminated vaccine was limited in amount, and you had every expectation that the rest of the vaccine was on track for this year. The problem with the FDA approach is that what you said turned out to be wrong. Things were not okay. Both British and FDA inspectors found systemic problems, including failures to address high bio burdens, problems addressing connection between tanks and sanitary practices that were found on previous inspections. So FDA was taken by surprise when the British came in and found out these problems. It seems to me obvious, if we had known earlier, we could have planned for the shortage. But why did the company provide FDA with information and projections that turned out to be wrong? Was it deliberate, or would it be fair to say the company was not aware of the severity of the problems and was optimistic any problems could be overcome?
Congressman Waxman, as I know you know this, the making of the flu vaccine is a terribly complicated thing. It's a new product every year. It's actually one product made up of three components every year. And you start, therefore, with a very large number of eggs. You put these seeds of viruses into the eggs, and you make it grow, and then you harvest it. And the process is complex, and that's the reason that you would have, as a manufacturer, these series of procedures for testing and retesting. In July 2004, as I testified before, our quality assurance program identified two batches of products that had sterility issues. And when that occurred, we thought that the scope of the problem did not appear to threaten any supply expectations that we had at the time. And we began to test and do these programs to investigate what caused it. This is the so-called root cause diagnosis and determination. And as you would expect, in making flu vaccines in the way that I've just described, by the way, at the peak of the production season, one can be talking about 400,000, 500,000 eggs. So what you alluded to is the bioburden issue. I think Commissioner Crawford has already testified. It happens. The trick is to make sure to have that you have a robust process, that therefore the end product does not have any of this bioburden. And we expected some failures in these internal testing programs. And that's why we were performing these confirmatory testing.
You thought they were isolated failures.
We did.
But you didn't think they were systemic problems, which, of course, the FDA report seemed to indicate.
We understand that. And as I testified before, this came to us as a surprise when it came on October 5th, when the MHRA had, as previously agreed, would come and take a look at our confirmative testing results. They said they will come. They came. The day after we finished the testing program, they came and looked at our results and did a three-day inspection. And at the end of the three-day inspection, gave us one sheet of paper saying that here are some of the observations which we responded to within 4 days. And the day after that, the MHRA concluded that there are issues with respect to the systems and processes of the entire plant.
Well, my concern, and I see my time is up, is that you were taken by surprise, the Food and Drug Administration was taken by surprise, and yet there had been an evaluation done in 2003 that showed systemic problems. And I don't think that the Food and Drug Administration I don't think they followed through. They should have been more on the case. You were taking over the company, and they should have been working with you together to make sure that these problems were dealt with. But when you had an increase in production and systemic problems, then it just led to the inevitable, what now looks inevitable in retrospect, a breakdown in the system.
Mr. Waxman, yeah. If I may point out the obvious, we are in a regulated industry. So if you're asking me to criticize our regulators, that simply isn't something that I can do, will do, or shall do. Look, we have a plan. We have a set of procedures.
Let me interrupt you. I'm not asking you to criticize the regulators. I'll do that job because I think they deserve criticism. But I think it would be interesting to know if you had had their observations early enough, whether you could have done something about the problem. And I'd submit that it just makes sense that if you know there's a problem and that you're not told there's a problem, you may or you may not catch it. But FDA's job should have been to be on the case to make sure these problems were dealt with.
Mr. Waxman, if I may, here's our situation now. We lost our license for this 90-day period. We're trying to get it back. And we're going to do everything we can that we can define clearly. Once we define those things that we can do, we will do those things subject to our assessment that we can actually do them. And I think what is extremely encouraging is that both the MHRA and the FDA have looked at this issue and this situation and this experience. And the two agencies, as I testified before, are working extraordinarily closely. So to the extent that your observations should inspire some lessons for all of us going forward, I think that inspiration has already been achieved.
Well, I thank you for that. That's certainly what we want, is in the future to have the problems corrected. I just want to make sure that people understand the mistakes that were made in the past so that they're never repeated again, and that we have a regulator that's doing a good job of regulating, because the purpose of it is to protect the public.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We concur.
Thank you. And let me say to my friend, to Mr. Waxman, that I think it's, in my opinion, after listening to everything today, there's no question that had the FDA gone in earlier or the MHRA gone in earlier,
and alerted them, we might have been able to avert this. But that was not part of their protocols at the time. I think they followed the protocols, as I understand. Doesn't mean they couldn't have done more or in the future shouldn't. And I think one of the lessons coming out of this, is particularly for foreign vaccine manufacturers, we need to be more vigilant and have more rigid protocols.
If you just yield to me, their protocols call for what they did, but they also call for an enforcement letter if it's more serious. And I would submit that this is not Rogaine. A product which I didn't use in time. But this is a product that is essential to the health of millions of Americans to avert the flu and the consequences for those who are at risk. And there should have been a higher priority and concern over the flu supply than to treat it in the same routine way they might treat Rogaine and other drugs that don't have the consequences of failure in this case.
Well, that is certainly a propitious comment, but I think FDA and Chiron have basically said to the committee that the inspection didn't show systematic problems in 2003. Is that correct? Yeah.
That is our understanding from the people who experienced the inspection.
And we may have a difference of interpretation here, but
let the documents that we put out today speak for themselves.
Exactly. It may be an interpretation.
Because the FDA inspectors thought otherwise.
But after they went back, I mean, I think the testimony is pretty clear that after they went back, as they do, and examined these, the biogenics, and they came back and talked about it, they decided it wasn't. But I think the documents will speak for themselves. We need to move forward, and I think that, Mr. Maxwell, one thing you've contributed very positively today is the fact that we need to be more vigilant in these areas. And whatever the protocols were, they need to be tweaked at this point as we move forward. We cannot allow this to happen again. And had we had earlier inspections, not only would Chiron maybe save a boatload of money, but we might have had more vaccine available to people this year. So let me just ask a few more questions, if I can, to the panel. I haven't had my 5 minutes yet. I just asked it. But go ahead. Mr. Tierney, go ahead, and then I'll wrap up. Go ahead.
I don't think I'm going to take a full 5 minutes, Mr. Chairman. I thought you had your five before. Let's segue into looking forward a little bit. Dr. Kohling, am I saying that correctly?
It's Kohling.
Kohling, I'm sorry. You talked about what we might do in terms of going forward to make sure that we have enough vaccine on the market. You know, this so far has been an industry that's been market-driven as opposed to government-driven or having government intervene other than the regulatory process. You talk about seeking tax incentives. Well, that obviously would take it outside of the market, free market aspect. And you talk about government stimulating demand. That would take it outside the free market aspect on that. So if industry can't survive or can't expand in a free market environment, and if you're going to ask taxpayers then to sort of use their tax dollars to invest in the industry, either by tax incentives or by mandatory public purchases, what do you think the industry would offer back to those taxpayers or investors as compensation or as a dividend for that? Would they offer up a share of the profits? Would they talk about price controls and a guaranteed supply? Would they talk about tighter safety regulations? Would they talk about contributions, as Dr. Klein talked about, in terms of a VIP type of situation, in case there's an error or injury to somebody? Would they talk about all of those or some combination?
Well, one thing that this industry, I think that's really misunderstood about how the vaccine, especially the flu vaccine industry, operates, is that it really is different from a lot of other things where you say a free market system.
Well, you operate for a profit, right?
Correct.
Okay.
Correct. But what drives this market is the recommendations of public health authorities. That is the major driving force in deciding who gets vaccinated and who does not.
Can I just back up a second? I think what drives it is individuals that either subscribe to get the vaccine or they don't, and their decision may be driven by some comments or decisions that the government makes, right?
Correct.
Okay.
It's primarily the Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices. They put out a list of who should and who should not get vaccine every year. And the American Academy of Pediatrics and the American Association of Family Practitioners also follow and in step with those recommendations.
Is that terribly different than companies that sell things for lowering your cholesterol, where the FDA and other advisory groups put out a word saying that you ought to take these medications to lower your cholesterol?
The main difference is when you are ill and you need to get a drug to change that situation, it's a lot different than most of us are walking around perfectly healthy. There's nothing wrong with us, except influenza will be coming. So
well,
there
is
an additional...
Well, I guess, my example, most people walk around with high cholesterol feeling great, not thinking there's anything imminent there either. So...
True, but what you do is you get those medicines are prescribed mm-hmm. for a condition, whereas we're in the area of preventive medicine. So there is a higher hurdle to get people to value influenza prevention. And
now, other industries would advertise.
Correct.
Do you?
We advertised the very first, our last year was our launch season, and 2003, and during our launch season,
I guess I don't mean to tag
did.
It all in your company. I'm talking about the industry, so I want to remove that from any personal thing on that.
Yes, there is some advertising, but primarily what happens is the guidance from the CDC and their advisory committees tell doctors who gets vaccine and when they get them.
Well, but the industry could advertise, as other industries do.
Correct.
If they want to drive a market.
Absolutely,
right?
Okay. Absolutely. But how vaccines are used is not usually driven by direct-to-consumer advertising.
If you chose in a free market environment to advertise mm-hmm. to drive your market, then that'd be one way to do it. You're mm-hmm. saying that your industry thinks it better to either have taxpayer incentives of some sort or public purchases. So my question that we haven't answered yet, and I'd like to get to, is what would the industry offer back?
What the industry offers back is new and improved vaccines that really will change how medicine is practiced in the United States. We haven't had great changes in our vaccine
industry.
Couldn't
we get that just by having NIH do the research, right?
By having, I'm sorry?
NIH or some other entity do the research.
Well, you know, NIH does a great job at doing research, but they don't make vaccines.
No, we could establish somebody to either give them the authority to or establish somebody that does, right?
Well, that comes at a price as well.
But I guess what you're telling me is the industry doesn't feel it would owe anything back to the taxpayers if the taxpayers became their investors.
I'm not saying that we necessarily feel that the government has to purchase strategic reserves or purchase unused vaccine. We would much rather make vaccine and have it used than stockpiled and maybe never used.
Okay. But the two things that you did recommend, one was tax incentives, all right, which would be a mm-hmm. taxpayer incentive. The other was public purchases for school children, mm-hmm. whatever.
It's a universal recommendation.
Universal recommendation, whatever. So again, why are you putting that burden on the government for industries that usually are talking all about the free market or whatever? Why not advertise and take it upon yourselves to use your investment and your stakeholders' investments to do that?
Well, first of all, we've invested much in this product.
Sure, of course.
Okay. And secondly, if the U.S. government invests in this product, what they get is they get to not have this kind of situation happening again.
Well,
and you get to not have
to
face
the
pandemic,
right?
Without having a vaccine as well. So I think those are things that are hard to appreciate because yeah. you don't worry about them until they happen. And that's the whole problem.
I guess I don't want
prevention.
To drive too fine a point on this, but let me just drive a real fine point.
Okay.
If we make you fabulously wealthy because you have all of these new customers or whatever, or you get tax breaks or whatever, why would a taxpayer not expect something back? And I don't expect, apparently you're not going to answer, and that's fine, but that would be the question I would have, and I would think a lot of taxpayers have. You know, if you're going to go out there and make a profit from the taxpayer's investment one way or the other, then why wouldn't they get some guarantees back that would be of value to them? But thank you for your colloquy.
Thank you. I'd probably be cheaper to do it through tax incentives and direct purchase, but that's an economic argument that we could get into. Let me ask each of you a few questions. Let me start. Dr. Cooling, with you, MedImmune right now is looking for universality. Is that correct in terms of being able to market it to everyone and getting those protections?
Correct. We think that's a good solution
to
stabilizing
solution.
The market.
You heard the FDA acting director today talk about how they were working toward that. Are we getting satisfaction in working toward that? Is there anything we can do to try to move that along?
Well, the Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices started talking about moving toward a universal recommendation a couple of years ago. And I think there's a lot of support amongst the scientific community and the medical community, the public health community. I think there's a desire to want to do that because we appreciate what could be accomplished if by those means. However, I think it comes down to it's going to be have to be supported by a lot of education for people to understand, number one, why is influenza a problem? Because often it's thought of as just a minor cold. We don't realize that 36,000 people die in the United States every year from complications due to influenza, and another 200,000 are hospitalized every year. Look at the cost of that to our society. So I think we need to educate people so that they understand how important it is to protect our citizens.
Also, Bo, we're also in your particular product trying to make sure that this would immunize older patients and younger patients. There's no evidence that it doesn't. It's just that the burden of proof is on you to show that it does. Is that correct?
We are trying to expand our indication down lower, below the age of five.
And higher.
And higher. So we have recently submitted new analyses of data that we have to show that the product is effective in adults from 50 to 64 years of age, and the FDA should be reviewing that soon.
Where is your plant that you manufacture?
Well, our manufacturing is done in three stages. The first stage is manufacturing of the seed viruses, which Mr. Penn has referred to, and we do that in Northern California in the Bay Area. Okay. So the seeds are made there. Then those are shipped to Liverpool, and our bulk manufacturing is done there. And then the bulks are shipped to our Philadelphia plant, and they're blended and filled into the nasal sprayers.
These are global viruses, then, as they move through. Okay. All right. I get it. Okay. Well, thank you. Thank you very much. We appreciate everything that you're doing. Mr. Peen, let me ask, the suspension of your license hasn't prevented you from procuring the materials necessary to move forward into next year. I mean, you're planning as if you're going to go full boat, correct?
What we're doing is we're defining all of the details of the implementation to achieve remediation, and it's going to take stages. And the first stage is to get the MHR to come back into our plant, probably in December, to look at whether or not they're going to be able to allow the three-month suspension of license expire.
But you have the eggs lined up and everything as if you're ready to go, right?
Yes.
And in fact, if you don't get licensed, you're stuck with a lot of egg. You'll be in the chicken business, aren't
well,
you?
Well, we will be in a different business than vaccines, yes.
So I mean, we appreciate that. That's a considerable risk for your company, just moving ahead in a case like that.
We recognize that.
Yeah. No, I think we appreciate it. I think it shows a can-do attitude here as we move forward. But I wanted to point that out. You feel encouraged in your work. Is that fair to say with MHRA and the FDA to ensure that you'll be able to manufacture for next year?
We feel encouraged in the approach that I've outlined in my testimony that has been has received considerable positive and constructive feedback from both the MHRA and the FDA.
The issues that were identified that led to the suspension of the license were not, they weren't facility issues. Were they more management issues, human factors issues?
Chairman Davies, that's largely correct. The MHRA did make some observations as to whether or not this machine should be here and that machine should be there. And also made some observations about our quality control system and testing program. All of those things are in the scope of our remediation plan proposal.
And let me just say for the record, I mean, we met with the FDA and we've met with the MHRA, and they were, I mean, everybody I think is working together on this, felt pretty good about where we're going, but there, as you say, there are no guarantees in this business.
No guarantees, first of all, but absolutely, and I think everybody has heard Mr. Waxman's suggestions about learning from our mistakes.
Yeah, I've heard a lot of them. It's here too. Dr. Strube,
how's Virginia doing at this point? Is the CDC making sure we're getting enough to take care of our vulnerable population?
We're getting our fair share. They're allocating it by population on it. And with this new database, and today we're triggering the ordering thing, ordering part of it, we'll be able to do the best we can with the limited vaccine that's available.
How's the vaccine dosage distribution information on the flu vaccine finder? How is that working? It's only available to state health officials. Is that working satisfactory from your perspective?
Yeah, it's getting better. Like I said, they upgraded it this morning before I left, and I played with it some where you can go in and actually now we can approve the ordering of vaccine and direct where it goes to on that system, on it through the distributor and through Adventus.
You notice some other states have gone out and gone to other foreign manufacturers that are not licensed by FDA, but FDA, we heard today, is looking at trying to give them some certification so they can bring it in. Has Virginia given any thought to doing that?
We've talked it over, but we have not done that.
You think you can get an adequate supply for the vulnerable population without doing that?
Well, we were worried about the timeliness, and so we've been working with what we have to get it out, and because we were really worried. We've had some cases in nursing homes already, so we went ahead and used some of the vaccine that we already had gotten for the public health side and just diverted it right away to the nursing homes to try to get them protected. And so, you know, we've been working with what we had, you know, and with the expectation if foreign vaccine does get approved, it'll be put through the CDC system, as I understand it, same way, and we should get a share of the 5 million that the FDA is working on.
Thank you. Dr. Klein, current flu vaccine recommendations cover people under the age of 2 and it says over 50 to include people who have underlying medical conditions and put them at high risk. Do you think the current flu vaccine recommendations are adequate, or should they be expanded to recommend it for all Americans?
I think the groups at risk are those that have been targeted, and those who have the highest hospitalization rates, the most morbidity, and the elderly, the mortality. But I think it's a matter of cost-benefit for employers who have employees who may have to miss work. Certainly, we make it a matter of importance that all health personnel be immunized, so not only do they stay on the job during an outbreak, but they don't pass on the virus to their patients. Right. And I think the same argument could be made in almost every venue. That the importance in preventing disease, in this case respiratory disease, does have a cost benefit and would be beneficial to all ages.
So an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure.
Well, you know, it'll be exam times. College students should be protected.
Sure. Would a universal flu vaccine recommendation also help ensure a stable flu vaccine supply?
I think so, in the sense that one of the goals, I think, of any program that addresses these issues should be to engage additional manufacturers, particularly domestic manufacturers, and if they have guaranteed market with some price structure that makes it profitable, I think they will return to the market and make that vaccine available. And then there'll be flexibility, so that if there's a problem with one manufacturer, it will influence modestly the vaccine supply.
You all have heard everybody's testimony today, the first panel with the FDA and the CDC and everyone else. Are we missing anything here? Is there anything else we ought to be doing that hasn't been discussed or recommended?
No, but I hope the various authorities, bodies of importance, direct long-term measures, not just to put out this fire, but to consider that this probably will occur in the future. That vaccine shortages have taken place in the past, the current one is important, and they will take place in the future unless we build in some new safeguards against that. But that'll take a lot of perseverance and continued interest.
Thank you. I would ask unanimous consent that the three statements previously submitted to the committee be entered into the record, and that objection so ordered. Mr. Waxman, you have any follow-up questions?
I do, Mr. Chairman. It's interesting to take note of the fact that we have a crisis right now. We have an inadequate supply for the flu season, for the vaccinations. Yesterday, a committee of the Senate held a hearing. Today, this committee is holding a hearing. Tomorrow, there'll be another committee in Congress holding a hearing. It's a subcommittee over in the Energy and Commerce Committee. Obviously, Congress cares a lot about this issue, appropriately so. We want to learn from our mistakes. But I want to ask you, Dr. Klein, you're one of the leading experts in childhood infections, and you served on the National Vaccine Advisory Committee. We're acting as if this has never been an issue. That suddenly we have a whole issue of vaccine supply, and we never imagined we'd have such an issue before us. Didn't the advisory committee present a report in October 2002?
It did, and many of the issues that I addressed are those that have been partially addressed, such as there was additional funding made available for vaccine stockpile. But because of the SEC regulation, that hasn't been implemented. But the others, because they're complex and they require perseverance, have been managed in a stopgap measure. And we need to reinstitute a more durable and set of advisory groups that will be able to address and propose specific recommendations that can alleviate the long-term problems.
So in before October 2002, your advisory committee was looking at the issue of how to give the right incentives for manufacturers to want to invest in producing vaccine, to make sure that they would have a sufficient supply, that the unsold batches wouldn't be a disincentive for them, for example. So their recommendations were made to set up a committee to look at that and give further thoughts to it. Is that what happened in October of 2002?
Well, actually, the workshop was in February of 2002.
Mm-hmm.
And as a result of that, there was an IOM report called Financing mm-hmm. Vaccines that was issued. But it in itself wasn't complete or wasn't sufficiently complete and was somewhat controversial. And so you need continuing activity to maintain until proposals that are satisfactory can be given to this committee and others.
So the Vaccine Advisory Committee proposed a multidisciplinary committee to be operating ongoing on an
yes.
ongoing basis to address these issues of vaccine supply.
That's correct.
Now, what happened to that recommendation? Was it adopted?
The recommendation for the ongoing?
Yes.
The IOM report was issued in the latter part of 2003. In June of 2004, there was an NVAC meeting that was specifically held to continue that dialogue. And we're interested now in progressing further so that something can be done. But the Vaccine Advisory Committee is just that. It's advisory to the National Immunization Program and the Assistant Secretary of Health and Human Services.
Well, we need the advice from the experts, and we had an advisory committee gave us recommendations. We had the Institute of Medicine give us recommendations. But from what I can tell, none of these recommendations have been followed up on, especially in this area where everybody's now for giving incentives for production of a vaccine so we won't lose supply. And face the problem we're facing now. Even Secretary Thompson seems to be talking about the importance of financial incentives. The point I want to make is we shouldn't wait for a crisis. We have advisory committees. In fact, your testimony here today is helpful, but it's advisory to us in many ways to have Congress act. And if Congress only holds a hearing, well, there's attention paid to the issue. And if the Secretary of Health and Human Services only pays a high priority to the issue when there's a crisis, and when there's no crisis, it's pushed aside, it's inevitable we're going to come back and repeat the same mistakes over and over again. Let me just ask you just parenthetically, because you know this issue very well. Is liability a strong disincentive for the manufacturing of a flu vaccine?
No.
It's not. Why not?
Well, the flu vaccine, for the most part, has been a very safe product. It's made in egg, so anybody with an egg allergy would be excluded from getting the vaccine. And there have been minor problems in the past. There was one experience with swine flu, where there was a neurologic disability that followed. And there are a couple of minor issues that occurred. But the reason for this current shortage is not liability. It's associated with a problem that Chiron experienced. That there are ingenious ways of getting around the current legislation and the vaccine injury compensation program is a given. And that's why that program needs to be reviewed constantly and assured that it remains as strong as it has been in helping the administration of vaccine, those who administer vaccines, as well as the manufacturers, be cleared of liability for approved vaccines.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think you're absolutely right on that, and I hope we'll get to, not on this committee, but on the committee that has jurisdiction, although this committee did come up with some recommendations on the vaccine compensation program. Mr. Chairman, I want to thank you for holding this hearing and thank all the witnesses for their testimony. I hope we can learn from this experience that we're facing now to do things better and to learn from our mistakes and hope that we don't make the same mistakes again, and the ones we do won't have the catastrophic consequences that we seem to be facing with so many at-risk people having a flu vaccine completely unavailable to them. Thank you very much.
Let me thank this panel, not just for testifying here today and sharing your views, but what we're doing outside of this hearing room and trying to get more vaccines to people in need. Thank you very much. Hearing's adjourned.